Internet, I'm so happy to announce that we are doing a one-year live anniversary show in New York City. Listen, we're doing it at that special place that we work
the Soho. The bathroom?
No.
Okay.
The We Work Soho location. It's an official tissue spot. And I'll tell you one thing. Internet, mark your calendars, May 4th, okay? 7 to 11, sponsored by UN Athletics. I'm telling you right now, listen. What we're doing is going to be a bunch of special guests will be in the building.
Expect the unexpected.
A bunch of past guests will be in the building.
Some free drinks going to be in the building.
Snacks, beverages.
Your baby mama might be in the building.
Giveaways.
We giving your baby mama away at the building.
Here's how you get involved. You're from New York City. Even if you, listen, come out. Even if you have to
travel. Yeah, get on that China bus. Stop playing. Get on the plane. If you want to come celebrate with us and you loving what we doing, we want to meet you. And even if you a hater, come through so you can see us shining. Shining love.
Internet, I want you to RSVP to this so we know who the fuck is coming.
That's
okay?
Right.
We need to count. PPSRSVP@gmail.com. Again, that's PPSRSVP@gmail.com.
That's easy.
RSVP to the joint is May 4th, marking in the calendar 7 to 11 in New York City in the WeWork Soho location space. It's going to be official, and I want to see you there.
Me too.
We'll see. Well,
you better come through. Don't be stunting now. You could come with your sweatpants, or maybe you want to wear a cat suit, because you never know who's going to be in the building. You might be able to snag you a baller at this event, lady. So put your good hair on, and it's going down.
Internet, PPSRSVP@gmail.com. RSVP to our live one-year anniversary event. See you there. Cheer.
Ow.
Internet, this episode is sponsored by the College of Hip Hop. We've already been telling you about the College of Hip Hop app, and it's official. The interviews they have there with different just industry people, man, just the contracts and just letting you know game. Listen, I always tell people keep an open mind, and I fuck with the College of Hip Hop for fucking with us.
That's right.
And I also fuck with them for creating something for people to check out. Listen, I've been told you, I'm going to tell you again, and people have been hitting me up, and I appreciate people hitting me up and be like, yo, I fuck with this College of Hip Hop app. You know, because that's what it's about. It's about putting people on. Tell a friend to tell a friend.
That's right.
The College of Hip Hop app is free 99. Go download that shit today. Tell a friend to tell a friend.
The game is to be sold and not told, but not in this case. In this case, you go right to your app store or your Play Store if you're playing yourself with an Android, and you get that app right now.
Now let's get to the show. Cheer.
Come on, everybody, get set, let's go. It's the next episode. It's the Premium Pete Show. News, interviews, all of the info. Listen up, it's the Premium Pete Show. If you want the scoop in the low, down low, listen to the show, cause Milk said so. Fuck what you heard, better act like you know. Miss Lissa knows. It's the Premium Pete Show.
Streets disciple, my rap's a trifle. I shoot tugs from my brain just like a rifle. Stampede the stage, I leave the microphone split. Play blink. It's the toughie while I'm on some pretty tone shit.
Yep.
Verbal assassin, my architect pleases. When I was 12, I went to hell for snuffing Jesus.
Whoops.
Nasty Nas is a rebel to America. Police murderer, I'm causing hysteria. My troops roll up in a strange force. I was trapped in a cage and let out by the main source.
Bars.
Yo, so, yo, right off the bat, first of all, Internet, welcome back to another episode of the Premium Pete Show featuring Miss Lissa Knows. Let me explain something to you.
Yeah.
Miss Lissa Knows is under the weather, so she is not coming with her original bars for her mixtape soon to be coming, Shit Must Be Easy, Volume 1. So we had a guest cover by the one and only Datwon Thomas. But listen, Datwon, I got to give you a better
intro.
That
was like historic, though. We never heard Datwon spit bars.
I was trying. I love that joint. It's better when Nas is with you.
Or when you got to be on your freeway, like, throw a beat on.
Let me ask you, we'll get into introducing you. But why did you choose that song?
Because that was the one that blew my mind. I blew my mind, man. That was 90, Main Source album, Live at the Barbecue. I remember being, at that time, I was in New Mexico.
Mm-hmm.
My stepdad was in the Air Force. So we were in Albuquerque, New Mexico. I was the only Brooklyn kid anywhere.
Oh, so you were a military brat.
Yeah, for like 5 years. I was 11. I was already who I was.
Right.
I was 11. We went to Japan for 3 years, came home for like a month, and then we went to New Mexico for a year and a half. And that album dropped while I was out there, and I was the ultimate hip-hop head. I was still the kid that was like getting stuff from my uncles and them. They would send it to me. I was selling Ewins out there. I was doing all type.
Shout out to Ewins.
I had all types of hustles. But that particular verse was like, I was like, who is this guy? Nobody knew Nas back then. There was no social media to like prep you for some kid that's on this underground hip hop group's album. And to hear somebody go off like that. And then I started hearing like, yo, he like 16, 17. I'm like, what? He's like not that much older than me at the time. I was like, I was bugging, yo.
But you grew up in Brooklyn for the most part.
Yeah. So born and raised Kings County, Lincoln Place between Washington and Underhill.
Talk about it.
Back and forth between Bed-Stuy, Brevoort Projects, where my pops and my grandmother and my cousins, everybody. Every weekend I was there, and then during the week I was with my moms in Crown Heights. It's really, we've been saying Crown Heights forever, but it's really Prospect
Heights. Exactly, exactly.
You know what I'm saying? So we was right around the corner from Brooklyn Museum. My block was wild. Like, my block was so wild. When you came before, when they had Lincoln going the other way, when you came up Underhill, they had in graffiti, you are now entering the Wild Wild West. Mm. And I remember like New York Times has said, like, this is crack kingdom, this block. And we didn't know that. You know what I'm saying?
What were you doing outside at that time? Like,
I was playing Skelly, playing ball on the buck, you know, on the block, freeze tag, doggy diamond. You know, all
sitting
that.
Sitting on the stoop.
Sitting on the stoop, bugging out, arguing.
What were the OGs doing to you?
They was definitely schooling us. I remember, like, when breakdancing and all that was really coming into play, and dudes would just come on the block extra fly, mad shell toes. And, you know, I'm a sneaker dude, so I think about times of, like, by sneakers, the leases and spot builts and all that in the Felis.
I'll never forget, I was talking with Sean Price, may he rest in peace.
Yes, indeed.
And he, you know, I mean, we all do. People who love sneakers do that, but we were going over sneakers with him.
Uh-huh.
I think it may have been on like an old episode. Me and Dallas had this podcast called Sneaker Fiends Unite.
Yep, yep.
And Sean Price was on there. I think we were asking him, like, we were just running down, you know, sneaker brands. And every brand he named, like, he was like, Spot Bills, first time I went to court. New Balance, like, first time I went for a job interview.
I got that.
Shit like that.
I got those.
And he remembers that. But I think that's just really the aesthetic of New York City growing up at that time.
It had to be, man. Like, you know, especially like in the early 80s, man, because you start and going into the mid 80s, you start getting hip hop culture, you know, forming, and it's a part of your life at this point. You know what I mean? And that's one of the things that I think a lot of the kids now, they're growing up into it, where we got to see it grow and we got into it. You know what I mean? And my uncles on my mom's side, all DJs. Pretty much, you know.
And so definitely in the music business.
Well, they wasn't in the music business. They was just doing parties.
But
yeah, you know what I'm saying? Like, they would, like, every
Friday.
Had
a love for music.
Super love from my mom to my grandmother. But my uncles was DJs. And this was back in the day when you went to somebody's crib, crates of records was part of, like, furniture.
Right.
That was, like, that was the makeup. Like, what records you got? What records you got? I mean, we had hundreds of records to the point where we was just putting shit on it. You know, on the crates, mad milk crates, we find one, be like, oh, this is going to be
That's
good.
When you couldn't walk too hard on the floor and, like, make you skid.
Yep.
I remember my mom be like, don't
move. Do it. Don't do it.
You got to be easy.
I'm about to start mixing. Yep.
You know, one thing, in these episodes, we always sometimes, like, we don't stay in order.
Yeah.
So, but I do want to say cool this. You grew up in Brooklyn. You grew up on a block that was super rugged.
Yeah.
How the fuck are you such a nice guy?
Yo,
and
man.
And the reason why I say that for is because, you know, for a while, too, like, I forgot who said this. Maybe it was Casanova.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, you grow up and I forgot how he said it. He said something about, like, why did he rob people? He said he was just jealous or some shit. Or he was mad or he's... Because, you know, we see in Brooklyn, I feel like a lot of us, and I'm sure other states could, you know, relate to this, but I feel like our OGs... You know, we wanted to be like them. They stunted.
We had the hot boys on the block.
Mm-hmm.
It was like.
And you
that.
Did you glorify them? Like, did you want to be like that when
Hell
you grew up?
Hell yeah, I wanted to be like my older cousin. Yo, this is so crazy. You bring that up, man. I think about my older cousin, Ronald. He's been locked up since '92.
Damn.
You know, and I'm supposed to go see him like this last week, and then something came up for me, and then I was supposed to come see him this week. Something came up, and I'm thinking like. How does he's so proud of me. How does he feel when what he's proud of me for delays me from getting to see him?
Damn.
You know what I mean? And like shit like that. And he was one of, he was the main one that I remember one time my uncle was like, y'all out here breakdancing and all this shit. There ain't no money. There ain't, this is a fad. Disco is going to take, and I remember my cousin Ron was like, hip hop going to be here forever. This how we going to make our money. This is, we making money right now. We out here. He was older. He was the man. Everybody respected him. And for him to say that and me be so young, I must have been like 7 or 8 at that time. Mm. In my head, it was like, yo, Ron said we can make money from hip hop.
So
you believed in that.
Because he was the one that everybody followed. He was the one that everybody believed.
So he spoke the gospel.
So when he said that, I was like, it was no doubt in my mind that that couldn't happen.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So when you think about people that glorify things or a negative aspect of life, you also think about how that person is a positive influence as well, you know, because of whatever negative thing happened. You know what I mean? And when I start thinking about it, I'm like, damn, man, that's crazy. Like, he helped get my mind wired for something else.
Did he keep you out of trouble too?
He was the one that was like, yo, Day, chill. And my cousin Junebug, who after Ron went up, like, he was the one that was with me all the time, picked me up from school. We go back so far, we used to race bottle tops in the pump used to go down the block, and whoever top reached the corner in the water next to the gutter got to watch the cartoon you wanted to watch.
Oh, nice.
That's how we used to play bugged out stuff like that.
What cartoon, when you won?
Oh,
I was
straight up and down G.I. Joes and Thundercats.
Okay, nice.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah, I was bugged out with it. But, you know, like memories like that come up when I think about being home and all of that. And then when I was in Japan, to go to your question about being nice, I wasn't all that nice leaving from, I mean, you got to think about Brooklyn, hardcore Brooklyn in the 80s. This is 86, going to beautiful cherry blossom Air Force Base, Yokota, Japan. Like, the culture shock was so much more, was so crazy going there than when I was coming home.
Right.
Because it was worse when I came home in 89. I looked around like, what the fuck happened? Crack had just decimated everything.
You went from a pizza bagel to a fucking sushi roll.
It was crazy. Exactly. But being out in Japan, you got to learn the culture of respect for one another. Mm. You know what I mean? Being humble, understanding your greatness is within you.
Right.
Being blessed by what's around you, all right. So the culture is kind of infused in you like that. So it kind of makes, it gives you a different thing. If you need to go into beast mode and you have that in you, cool, but you don't have to be on it 100 times a day like you have to be in the city.
That had to benefit you because, you know, I'll be honest with you, the reason why I brought that up for is because, you know, I know you for a minute and you've been around in this industry, in this game for a long time. You're well respected by a lot of people.
Appreciate that.
No, I mean, I'm a lot, what I see. Mm-hmm. And you're just a good dude.
I appreciate,
like, you know,
it,
you're not like, you know, like, you know, sometimes people are just jerk offs.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like,
we know them all.
Maybe sometimes I'm a jerk off. No,
yo, but that's, I don't mean, most of the part of people is, makeups, man.
No, but what I mean by that is you, I think one of the hardest things to figure out, and even for me, is learn, like when Jay said, I'll show you how to move in a room full of vultures. I tell people all the time not to take things too personal.
That's
because
real.
What happens is, you know, you lose things from that. You could lose relationships, opportunities. Oh, and I'm saying that because I've done that.
Yep.
Because I'm one of them Brooklyn guys. What the fuck, are you trying to abuse me? You can't bring street shit into this shit all the time.
So, and that was the thing. That was the thing about me getting into this. It was like, this is an entertainment game at the end of the day.
Mm-hmm.
The street stuff is going to be the street stuff. I've seen and witnessed and been involved like with real problems. Somebody not showing up for a photo shoot or saying something slick on whatever, that's not a real beef. It's so not. I've, like, real shit is real shit. There's only been a couple of times where I thought in this game, I've been doing this for 20 years now, officially.
Mm-hmm.
This year makes it official.
Congrats.
20. Thank you. It's been a couple of times where I thought it was like, all right, this is real shit. Less than the fingers on my right hand.
But even the artists you've dealt with, think about it. How many artists you have dealt with?
Oh, my God.
That think you're a good dude. it's not easy, too, because if you're not going to write something up well mm-hmm. about a person, if you're not going to give them the right coverage, if you're not going to help them, kind of some people are like, fuck you, Datwon.
Yeah, and like, you gotta live with that. Everybody's not going to be happy with the fact that you say, like, yo, the album isn't all that. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Have you had any, not cause any problems?
I've had those, yeah, definitely. Mm-hmm. But when I say something that could turn into realness, like realness, that doesn't mean that I haven't had my full-on share of dumbass drama. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like shit that you look at now and laugh at, but when it was going on, you was like, this is some dumbass shit. Wish I could smack the shit out of somebody. You know what I'm saying?
What could be some advice that you give people to get through some drama in the music industry?
I would say, like you said, do not take it personal. Mm-hmm. One of the things that helps keep me grounded within this, and I had to deal with it just this past weekend in L.A., I try to think about why the other person is acting this way. Mm. And if I can't come up with a reason that's within my vision, then I'm like, that's their issue. So let me not go into their bag and try to figure out their bag. If it's not laid out in front of me where it's like, oh, Day, you did this right. or this situation happened, then I don't go into it looking at them as the most evil person. I'm like, yo, they going through something. So let me diffuse it. I'm the one that jumps on the grenades. If I don't do that, then everything blows up.
Right.
Because yeah. I know I'm strong enough to take the power of the grenade. If I'm able to jump on it and I survive, then I did my job. Mm. That's how I look at it.
Shit, I like that, man.
Something I notice about, like, some of the veterans, like, I feel like back in the day, people were more honest about their opinions in certain projects.
No
but
doubt.
I feel like now people step on like eggshells and are afraid to really speak out. And even more so like the vets, because they want to maintain certain relationships with these new artists mm-hmm. or stay relevant in these younger generations. Like, how do you keep from doing that? Or do you even have times where you feel like you do it?
I think there's a balance.
Right.
There's a time when... You know, you don't have to, it's funny, I look at some of the things on social, you don't have to say the most negative thing about things that's obviously negative. You know, it's a little bit easier. Sometimes I look at the people that are the most critical
right.
on projects, they like to go for the easy, the low-hanging fruit that's negative. It's like, oh, Lil Yachty. It's like, it's so easy to pick at him.
Right.
I want to see you be critical on Nas or be critical on somebody that's done greatness and you know it's not up to that level. Going after these kids that's trying to find a way, that's real easy.
That's true.
You know, and then when you try to look at how critical they are within whatever field or whatever artist, it's not even detailed enough for you to be like, oh, that's a, you know, a quality assertion.
Right.
You know what I mean? So a lot of times I look at some of the negative stuff as like, you corny too. You know what I'm saying? You corny too, because you're not even picking something that's making you actually critique.
Right.
You know, and a lot of people just ride waves. You know what I mean? Oh, everybody don't like this person? I'm going to do that. I go by what I like, regardless of anybody fucking with it or not.
Yeah, well, I think that's the exact way to be. You know, I want to definitely, I want to take this into an evolving point, because I feel like you've been able to evolve. But before we even go there...
Right.
We didn't
people
even
gotta tell him who he is.
We did say who the cover is. Anyway,
the people that know, they know. Once you said Datwon Thomas, mm-hmm. but for like the newbies, the mm-hmm. internet.
Well, what's the AKA? How many AKAs you have?
Day Dog.
Just mainly Day Dog.
I like
Day,
to call him
DT.
I like to call him Rich Homie Twan.
That's okay. A new one. Okay,
but yeah.
Well, listen, good guy. You know,
appreciate that, bro.
Editor in chief.
Of a lot of things.
Well, yeah, now Vibe.
Vibe yeah, Magazine.
Started at Vibe. He's back at Vibe. Mm-hmm, started mm-hmm. as an intern for Vibe.
Yes,
all
indeed.
The like a quarter.
Yeah. You
make
you
that phone
that
call.
Listen, revolving door. We'll get to all that. But listen, internet's Datwon Thomas.
Yo,
in the fucking building.
Man.
How are we giving an intro later on?
Yo, that's dope, man.
No,
because like
it's
that.
Like a Lifetime movie. You got to take them back before you can take them forward.
Where the credits still be going like 20 minutes later.
I agree.
You know the Lifetime movie that start at the murder and then they go back.
I feel
introduce
you.
Introduce what happened.
I agree.
He's been killing it. So we on the murder scene already.
There we go.
Yes,
you know,
indeed.
But you know, let's get to evolving.
Yeah.
Many people who are in the business for 20 years
mm-hmm.
don't always evolve.
Right.
And the reason why I mean... You know, they're stuck in the past.
Yeah.
You know, you think about even like, you know, people like our parents.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they may think that, you know, getting a job, 9 to 5, you know, 25 years, get a pension, retire, get on Social Security, and die.
That's it.
You know, now our age is looking at our kids, and maybe if they don't want to go to college, understanding that they may become an entrepreneur.
Right.
They may try to open up an app.
Yep.
They may try to whatever. We're more open. We're not judgmental.
That dream is realized now because of social media and the internet and digital revolution. You're able to see that. A lot of times when we were coming up, like in the 90s, you know, approaching the 2000s, you know, we could almost see this time, but it wasn't all the way here yet.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
But not everybody trusted it,
Everybody didn't trust it, man. You had to jump out with that parachute that might have had a hole in it.
Exactly. There's still people who live like that. You know, listen, I have a friend my age. I'm going to tell you a story. I have a friend my age.
Yep, yep.
Exactly. I mean, I grew up with him.
Yep.
Friends 35, 30-something years.
Yeah.
30-plus years. He is the total opposite of me.
Uh-huh.
What I mean by that, I was like, yo, I'm like, I think he had bought me something. So I said, yo, I want to send you money. Download this Cash App.
Wow.
You ever heard of the Cash App?
Cash App.
He's like, I don't trust it. I'm like, there's nothing to not trust. What are you talking about? You put your debit card in and it will go right there and you can put it in your bank account. But he doesn't trust it.
But he's like, you got a debit card. You had to trust something.
I know, but that took a long time to get that.
Right, right.
Like, what I mean is he thinks like he doesn't. You know what I mean? I mean, look.
They're not early adapters. I've been listening to Gary Vee, you know.
Yeah. I love Gary Vee.
Yeah. He just liked a tweet of mine that I shouted him out. And I was like, all right.
Okay. He's trying to come up to vibe.
Yeah, exactly. The early adapters, man, those are the ones that win. People that go ahead and look at some kind of technology or innovation. It doesn't even have to be digital. It could be something with cars or whatever.
Right.
And they see, like, there's opportunity here. I don't know exactly what this is, but I'm going to go ahead and mine it and see where I get in.
Right. Sure.
And that's why now you got all these apps and everything, and you see like the investors for, you know, Troy Carter, investor for this, that, and the third, and Gary, investor for this, Nas, investor for this.
Yeah, Sweet Chick, all that.
Early adapters. And you really got to, it's risk versus reward, man.
Right.
You got to be like, yo, is that what I want? Let me take the risk. You know what I mean?
Yeah, like something that Gary Vee said to me, and I was like, it's going to stick with me forever, was you got to like wake up and try to put yourself out of business every day.
Every day. Mm-hmm. I remember my man that had, he just started, he didn't just start it, but it's called Ozzy, Ozzy.com. I was working with them for a little bit, and Steve Jobs' wife, Lorraine Jobs, she's one of the founders with my man Carlos Watson, and when he was putting the whole team together out there in Silicon Valley, he was like, every day we have to think like the brand that's coming after us.
Mm.
Every day.
I agree with that.
The brand that's coming after us is happening. Right. We don't know them, so we got to think like them.
Right.
And got to stay open-minded.
Oh,
so that goes to my question. How did you stay open-minded to evolve? Because you could have, look, you're from the old school. You could have got stuck.
Easy.
How did you evolve?
I'll tell everybody, as crazy as it was, when you think about it, the fact that my mom was like, yeah, we're going to go to Japan, that just opened my whole world up automatically. The only place I was really traveling back then was like South Carolina, you know, different summers here and there. And, you know, my grandmother down there instilled crazy values into me. But being able to see the world from Japan, we used to take a flight for $10. We used to go to Seoul, Korea and get like Dapper Dan suits made.
Mm.
With like, you know, Gucci, I was coming back with Gucci suits and Fendi suits and all that.
Straight
from the source. I'm walking the street as a 12-year-old. I'm walking the streets with my men, walking around getting swatches and telling them how I want my cut and stuff. And my mom's from Brooklyn and she was letting me rock. My mom's was,
My mom's
gangster, man. She let me rock. Like, yo, go ahead and explore the world.
You grew up with mom and dad, or they were separated?
Nah, they were separated. They were separated when I was a baby. So,
okay.
But my dad was with us for a little bit. And then now me and my dad, best friends.
Okay.
Best friends. I was always with him on the weekends and stuff like that. He holds all
good
types
dude.
Of, super good dude. If you think I'm a good dude, he's the greatest.
I can't imagine that.
Yo, he's the greatest. He's the greatest because he's a really good guy.
So good guy and mom was down to earth.
My mom's is a gangster.
That's
though.
A representation. <that's, laughs>
my mom's favorite. If we call her right now and you ask my mom's who's her favorite group, she'll say Mobb Deep. And you'd be like, what's your favorite song? Getaway.
That's okay. My stuff.
Yo,
okay.
That's my mom. Stuff. So my mom and my dad are like polar opposites on that accord. My pops wouldn't even know what group would be. He'd be like, who, Stylistics? Like, what are you talking about?
Pops is listening to Billy Dee Williams.
Yeah, that's he from that era. Like,
hey,
you know
listen,
what I mean?
Ain't nothing
from
wrong that era.
But my mom's is on it like this. Like, yo, Little Yachty New joined us. Hot. You ain't here yet? That's my mom.
That's where you get it from.
Yeah, that's where I get that from.
So you're saying that having a chance to travel young at an early age.
And his mom being so open to, like, you know, mm-hmm. grooming his
and
brilliance.
Letting him be. Yep.
You don't want to dim yeah. those lights.
Yo,
so you're saying that helped you have an open mind?
Oh, no question. That opened up me being able to have the antenna to pick up frequencies from people. Mm-hmm. And I know that sounds crazy. Like, whenever Erykah Badu be talking that stuff and be sending little sounds and stuff, I be like, yo, I'm tuned in. It's like, you're on that level. You know what I'm saying? Be like, yo, I'm on that level. But being out there, I was able to meet people from so many different cultures. I mean, you had people that were Taiwanese and German. You know, because their families went so many different places and they met
right.
their wives and all these culture clashes were happening. And I learned a lot. So it let me know that, oh, it's more than a block. I know it sounds cliche, but it was way more than a block.
But it's needed. It's needed.
Listen,
my daughter, I tell her all the time, she lives in Brooklyn.
Yep.
Okay. That's where I grew up. I lived in Brooklyn all my life until I moved to Jersey, you know, when I met my lady and had a kid.
Yep.
You know, I tell her all the time, you don't want to just be a Brooklyn girl. Get off
right.
the fucking block.
Yeah.
What are you going to do for the summer? Let's go, you know, like, you know, because I think that, you know, it's funny, too, because I remember a long time ago when we sat down with RZA.
Okay.
He explained that he benefited his uncle. You know, he grew up where he grew up, you know, it was rough, rugged, you know what I mean? He said his uncle used to have an uncle like in Florida or something, and they used to go there every summer.
Yeah,
that helped him.
Oh, no question.
Be who he is today. He credits that. And listen, I'm so glad that you brought that up because, you know, I can't wait to do that with my son as he gets older. And what I mean by that is, I think you should let your kids travel at a young age on these programs at school.
I'm scared.
No, I don't.
My daughter's
fresh
going.
Fresh air front. I'm scared.
She's going on her college tour in like another week.
Well, that's old enough. He's
yeah,
talking about
yeah,
like,
but she's 16. But at the same time, it's like a lot of kids don't even get to do stuff like that until after they're in school.
True.
Or
right.
You know what I mean? Or they're like, yo, you know what? I ain't even going to go to school. I'm just going to work. And then that delays them from being able to go and travel even
right.
more. So it's like, yo, as young as you can, you know, just get away a little bit.
Sure, she.
Pete trying to get me to send Brielle to like a sleepaway camp for the summer. I'm like, she is going to be eight. I can't do it. And she got a sassy mop. I just know they going to do some
she's
things.
Not the only,
she's going to be in a sunken
she's
place.
She's not the only one in there.
No, she wouldn't. And what can happen is that can open her to other things as well. You know what I'm saying?
Scared.
I want to explain to you why. And this is the reason why I'm explaining to you why I believe in this. And I wish I would have been able to do it with my daughter, but it was hard to do it because, you know, being separated, me and her mother didn't see the same eye to eye.
Right.
I'm explaining to you. Not everyone is like this, but I want to give you my experience and what I think hurt me. My mother is a great person.
Mm-hmm.
Great. I feel like they don't make people like her anymore.
It's a different breed, man.
But she wasn't good for me in certain points I'm going to try to make to you.
Yep.
She was so good that it didn't give me independence until late. Like, my mother, like, you know, I never forget, when I got divorced, I had to go back home.
Yeah.
Because it was unexpected. I didn't know, you know, I had to go back home to get back on my feet.
Yeah.
When I went back home, this fucking lady was like, you want pasta tonight? Chicken cutlet, eggplant parmesan?
Yeah.
I did your laundry. You know, I was like, what the
fuck? The room is still the same.
I was like, yo, I'm never leaving.
I'm not leaving,
But the point I'm trying to make is, I did that a little bit with my daughter, too.
Yeah.
And I love her, and my mother loves me.
Yep.
But if you love your kids, and this is for you, Mrs., if you love them, set them free.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Let them find their way. Like, you know, I'll be honest with you. One of my biggest problems and why I felt I had so many issues, I took too long to grow up.
Mm.
I didn't grow up until I was in my 30s.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, like, you know, if you make a kid, like, my lady is totally different than me.
Right.
She grew up at a very, very young age.
Yep. Same here.
You know?
Same
She's
here.
A Leo, so we a little more
No,
mature.
But what I'm saying is, you know, learn how to be independent. You know, I was talking with Datwon off air about how when I grew up, especially when I was in the areas of, like, the Italian guys, where I felt I glamorized the gangsters.
Right.
But if you really think about it, if you know what gangsters are, they don't fucking put any money in the bank. They don't do their taxes. What else did I say? They don't have anything under their name.
Right.
So you're not really building your credit. So who are we fucking looking up to? No, but what I'm trying to say is, you know, you give yourself a chance to see more. You know, listen, I love being from New York. Wherever I go, I
That's why I like my son, because he was saying stuff like that effect as well. Like, how you saying God blessing all the trap niggas, like, maybe you don't know the same trap niggas that they know. Like, they're not winning. Like,
they're not my blessed.
He was going off. He was going off all weekend. I am here for him.
But I don't want to get lost of where the fuck. I started to go into one of my rants.
Yes, you did.
But
can we get into his marriage business if we're talking about that?
No. I want to go back to... hold on. I know where I'm going. Let's go back to... well, we spoke about evolving.
Yeah.
We spoke about where, you know, basically... You know, being a military brat, I call. And I tell you one thing: shouts to all the military brats worldwide, because I feel
is
like
that like being called that.
No, I think that's
I mean
what
it's like a badge of honor in a way. Okay. You know what I mean? I wasn't. Some of them are lifelong; like they were born into it. I came into it. I was already 11 by the time you know it happened, and I was out by the time I was 15.
Okay,
you know, 16, yeah, 15, 16. I was out. We was back in Brooklyn, back on the block in 91.
Looking
Did you
fresh.
Already love writing while you were out there? Like, were
Definitely.
You already tapping into that?
Definitely. I was in there writing little raps. You know, it was dope. Like, I had always loved reading, though. I was always picking up, you know, in Japan, they got the Japanese, you know, the anime and all that, comic books and all that.
You speak Japanese?
I wish I kept it.
Konnichiwa.
Okay, I can't. Konnichiwa, Ohio Design Mess. All that shit. But we used to have to study it and all that, but I ain't keep up with it.
Dang.
I wish I did.
That would have been hot.
I know.
That would have been hot.
My homegirl, she got me a workbook. My man, A-Wife, Rochelle. Rochelle, I know I got to do that workbook joint. But she got me to work, but like, yo, work on it.
Yeah, that would be done. Maybe it's like riding a bike and just get back on it.
I wish I could, because we lived off base out in Yokota, which is crazy. Mm. No one did their whole 3 years off base but me and my family.
And that's luxury, right? Yeah,
well, on base is luxury. Yeah, off base.
Oh, okay, I thought the off base was like, okay, you're right.
I don't
on base is the houses,
wild.
Right?
Yeah, it's the houses. Mm-hmm. But I was on base a lot, but it was weird, and it was almost like, you live in the projects.
That's how I felt just now when you said it.
Yeah, see what I'm saying? Exactly. You see, so imagine having that. I was that kid. Even though out there, I was still a project kid.
Right.
I was like, because we had, it was a project. It was this place called Caesar's Palace, and it was six floors. It was hood, and everybody stayed there for a short amount of time until you get called on to go on base.
Right.
Every 3-4 months, my mom and my stepdad would go and check the list, and we was always getting bumped down because someone more senior was jumping in.
Mm-hmm.
And that was his first base anything.
Right.
So it was wild to be the project kid in Japan.
That's crazy.
All the way out there. And after a while, I just got used to being that and staying on base with my friends and stuff like that. But then when we went to New Mexico, I was on base. That was a Kirkland Air Force Base.
You know, so many reasons why I keep on appreciating military brats is I feel like most of any, like I would say all of the ones I met, super creative.
Oh, no question,
I mean, super talented, super creative. And, you know, again, that's why I say let your kids, you know, travel with the schools. Schools have things where they go away to Italy sometimes, you know.
Yeah.
You don't have to pay so much money, but, you know, a little bit. I listen, when my son comes around and that happens, I'm going to let him do it because I feel like us New York people, right?
Yeah.
We're so tough the way we talk. Like, I remember being, like, you know, talking with people. We talk so, like, our mouths are crazy. Pause.
Yeah.
but what I mean is we haven't even been to any places, really.
Yeah.
A lot of us haven't been off the block.
But it's because New York is such a melting pot. Mm-hmm. You could go to Manhattan and be in Little Italy. You go
in
Chinatown.
Africa.
You be up
in
Little Haiti.
Like,
yeah, like, they got even, recently I saw a Little Brazil block. I was like, this is Little Brazil? Yeah, it's something like Little Brazil.
What was that?
So, you know, you already feel like you're in an international, you know.
You're right.
But
I didn't look at it like that.
But then, when you actually go to the places that we're mimicking and you realize, like, oh, this is Italy. I went to Milan, like, yo, this is the Duomo. This is way different than being on Mott Street somewhere.
Right.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
It's better than Bertos.
Yeah, it's crazy. And when once I got into the game, even after, you know, being in Japan and stuff, I got to travel. I got to be out. Mm. You know what I mean? And I've gone all over the world because of my, you know, openness at a young age to travel.
Yeah.
And internationally. That was the other thing.
Passport right. stamp, young,
yo,
huh?
My passport was crazy.
Woo! I'm jelly.
What up, Ho? Yo, I was speaking to kids, and, you know, you have, how many kids you have?
3 girls.
Okay, and the oldest one?
The oldest, 16, 14, okay, 16. And 10.
My daughter, you know, turned 17 last week.
Nice. Know? Happy birthday,
thank
princess.
Thank you. You know, and it's... I feel like an old person or a young old person.
You're old.
I'm old. No, but you know what? Speaking of music, speaking of hip hop, speaking of giving them opportunities to be set free and do what we didn't get to do. Because every parent should want to do that. You want to give to your kids what you weren't able to do.
No doubt.
When did you start listening to hip hop with your kids?
Oh wow!
And what did you let them listen to? Because let me tell you something. That's a big.
It's a huge thing.
It's a big thing because do you have to put the clean version on?
I fight with them on that. The oldest, she's 16. She's a junior. We're not hiding anything.
Right.
And what's crazy is some of the crazier things, like a Future or whatever, that sparks conversation with us. And it also is kind of crazy. I don't know how other people are doing it, but it opens a conversation for me to have that drug talk with her.
And be so it like, gives you a segue.
It's a segue a lot of times.
Smart.
You know what I'm
saying?
It's like, yo, so wait a minute. So y'all dancing, because even like some of the dances that they do, like for CHEA and all that stuff, is to these songs. It's like, yo, you know what that is? Or like, what are kids
Mask
talking
off.
About this?
Mask
yeah,
off.
Yeah, like, yo, Percocet.
Molly Percocet.
It's like, yo, what the hell? And then, you know, we end up having these conversations. And this is actually as of late, because every time we get in the car, if something like that is on, I'm like, yo, the clean version, y'all. Right. What are you doing?
My daughter's father today had on all of the Dirty Versions. And he put on Bad and Bougie. Like, I was just sad.
There's no way that they're not hearing it. You know what I'm saying? They have their own phones. They got, you know, all of that's happening. They know how I feel about it. But at the same time, we talking. When I was that age, my mom wasn't like parental advisory. You can't listen to that. Right. I don't think my mom ever once told me I couldn't listen to something crazy. And she was buying me hip-hop records. But they weren't as vulgar back then. You know what I mean? Like, now it's just out of control.
It's like not even
YouTube
little.
Crazy. That stuff, we
bust
put blocks
nut,
on.
Suck my dick.
Exactly. Like, and then you're like, oh, hey, oh, oh.
Yeah, they were fighting the powers before. They were using the music to do something, to say something.
Although, if you know, not too long. I mean, it wasn't that long ago, but it was long ago. Even like, look at something like Uchiwali.
Uchiwali was crazy, but
you know,
I think,
in your mouth, Akineli.
Yeah.
You know?
That's straight direct. Uchiwali is still a little a little bit of mystery where he's talking about it a little bit, maybe not on the uncensored version, but
yeah, the clean version got you confused.
Yeah, you'd be like, what? But now on the radio, if I'm driving them to school, it's something crazy. Like, you know, Sex With Me would come on. I'm like, whoa.
Sex With Me.
She's not cursing.
So amazing.
She's not cursing.
But my daughter asked me if that was a bad word. I told her yes.
But if you say the word sex, it's not a curse word.
That's a curse.
It's not a curse word. It's an actual act. And then it's on the radio and they're not censoring it. So then it's like, oh, it's okay. So now you're like, oh, you can't hear this. Right. We're turning from it.
And keep in mind, we're in a day and age where Sirius is going to play straight up whatever the thing is. It may not just be radio where it's clean cut.
Yeah.
You know, because I'll tell you one thing. Being a parent has helped me, I think, like have like a bigger mindset.
Right.
Because, you know, it's like we sit here and we think of like even something like Akineli. You know, I remember being in a club and girls are just turning to the left and turning to the right and they just like, put it in my mouth. And I was like, yo,
I hated that song.
Now when I hear that shit, I'm like, yo, if I see my daughter doing that shit, I'll smack the shit out of her.
I hated that song. Yeah,
but then again, you can't control
what they're not going to play that in front of you.
No,
but they're going to definitely hear it.
It's almost like that's why, you know what? That's why. And I always give credit to Clark Kent.
Yeah.
Because when my daughter started to get older, I asked him for some advice, and we sat down, and he had told me, like, yo, keep it 100 with her.
Yep.
And I mentioned this a lot, like, and I told her everything, about everything from condoms. I even went as far as telling her how guys like to get away with wearing a condom by saying, let me just put the tip in.
Yeah.
And that was the weirdest conversation.
You told your daughter the tip conversation?
Yes.
That's real.
Recently,
that
was, right? Last year?
Like yeah, 16, no. This was about like 2 years ago. Yeah, you're right. About two years ago.
16, 17, yep. Okay, that's old enough.
About 2 years ago. But that was so awkward to have.
You got
to
do it, though. Mm. I had a similar one not too long ago, like maybe a couple of weeks ago, because we start to see the uptick of like young boys liking your daughter. You know what I mean? She just had
her
sweet...
She got a gram?
Yeah, she got a gram, but she don't even... she don't even really be on it. And I'm like, yo, wait a minute. Her snap is the other thing.
Yeah, see.
You know, it's really
just going in 24 hours.
Yeah,
that's the cover.
That's the cover. It's like, oh, just for dad. And then, you know, the family trying to throw everybody off. You know what I mean? But she think we crazy. But at the same time, you're a junior in high school. I know what I was doing as a junior in high school. You know what I'm saying? You got to be realistic, and you got to be like, all right, look, I want you to have all the knowledge that you can about how boys are and what goes down. And make sure that you're cognizant when someone's trying to game you.
Word of the day.
You know what I'm saying? Like, you got to be up on that. So those kind of conversations are definitely difficult, but you have to have them. Because especially if you're there, that you want them to know that they can come to you too. And they're not going to always come to you. But you got to leave the door open for them to do that.
Like Brielle asked me yesterday about babies. And I said, well, you know, when you a grown up and then you have the baby. She said, but wait a minute. Don't teenagers have babies?
Smarter,
and I was like, yes.
Listen, this is your daughter. You know how you are.
And she's like, what does that mean? I said, that they mother's bad.
Yo. You have.
Yeah, you'd be feeling. You be filling her with all the wrong things, but meaning well.
Yo,
but honestly, this is, I'll be honest with you, I love having these conversations. Yeah. It's good for the internet to hear because,
it's
you know.
It's convo on their side.
Well, also because, you know, we need, you know, like, it's always good to get advice from
all
people. And especially people who have their mind in the right state.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that, you know, there's no booklet to be a mom or a dad. There's no manual. No, we just follow our hearts.
Or to be in love. Or to need help.
Yeah.
And you guys are in love. You're married. You about to get married. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. How do you do it in this industry? Is your wife in...
No, right?
Mm-mm. She like a nurse?
No nurse. She's just not like doing the industry thing. You know what I'm saying? She's like, nah. She works.
Do you think you would be able to have been together so long had she been in the industry?
I seriously doubt it.
Datwon was the editor-in-chief of King Magazine. Yeah. He got all his woes out of his fucking...
He created that one.
But you know what's so funny about that? Like, whenever this conversation comes up about King and everything, and my wife, like, she used to help me pick some of the girls. And at one point, I was like...
Oh, and so you were with your wife when you did that?
Yeah.
Man, you are a good dude, man. You are a good dude. Because I'll be honest with you, I would have gone single for that time being. You know what I mean? Just to be like...
Just be like, yo, we need a break.
While we doing this publication.
we need some time off.
Exactly. Because you know what? I always like... You know, I've always stayed faithful to the girls that I want to be with and stay with and build with. But more importantly, I've always had a dream to be like one of those interviewers at like a stripper club, you know? So I would just sit there like, how you doing? All right, let me see what you got.
All right,
come here for a second. Let me see. You want to go work tonight? You know, like, just like, so being in like something like the King Magazine.
Yo, that used to be our casting joints. They used to come through. We used to look at the girls, be like, all right, cool, she's the one. We had them all over the country, yo.
Do you think that things like that are like things that would be like a problem now? Like, meaning, like, think about it. Like, when people say, like, I forgot who said this. It's like if a restaurant, the guy, I never forget, this guy was like, talking to me about like hiring people. He didn't even know how to do it. He didn't know me that well. But he's like, I like to get waitresses with big tits. And I was like, you know, and he's like, yeah, if you know anybody who wants it, I'm like, and I was like, I understand what he's saying, but I was like,
he had a look.
Yeah, but
he had a look. Like, certain people, and not to cut you, but I'm just saying that was his criteria because he knew something about his customers. Mm. Or the kind of customers he wanted, or if
he might just like titties,
he might just want
be
that. It might be his casting couch, like
right.
You know what I mean? Like that's what I'm saying. So there's a criteria that people have in those kind of positions. There was a criteria that we had. Our thing was like, yo, if you're beautiful, if we feel like you have like this spirit, then cool. Most people are like, nah, y'all just wanted the video girls. Nah, go back through the whole thing. We definitely did our best to have a spectrum of beautiful right. women in different ways.
Do so you for feel those, sorry? Uh-huh. No. Do you feel like IG is the new King magazine?
Oh, no question, no question. I think that's one of the reasons why some of the brands that were so powerful back then, they kind of struggle now because you're getting it for free.
That's a fact.
Yeah. Oh, we was charging
sink
people
in a trip to DR. And you're a King magazine model.
Wait, would you say a sink?
A sink. You sit on a sink and make it look more cakey.
And then you good. More cakey. That sounds like something. I like that magazine. More cakey magazine.
More cakey.
Look at that. We always
you
do
always
this.
You always do
stuff.
This.
Yeah, we always do this.
He's a brainstorming, these fucks.
More
He's
cakey.
Brainstorming. Listen, you for those who don't know, uh-huh. King Magazine.
Yes.
Was
yes.
What kind of magazine was
it? It was
men's magazine.
Men's urban
model,
lifestyle, model,
sexy.
Cars. We had everything. And yeah. we had so much more than just what
And you
the
created
cover had.
That.
And I created that. Yeah. Definitely.
And it became a magazine.
Very popular.
Give me some numbers. It sold what?
Millions.
Millions.
When you do it all together. It was a run that we had where we were percentage wise, we were outselling. I think we was outpacing Oprah magazine.
Really?
Just on a percentage side, not on sales, but on a percentage size for us, our growth.
Right.
We grew so fast, man. Yeah. Like, and I think it was because I really just wanted to talk to the dude that was in the barbershop in Hood, USA, young black guy. He's getting his cut. What he doing? And back then, you didn't have the gram and
right.
your phone and all that.
Right.
What you doing? You either talking crazy shit about basketball and all that with the dudes. You're talking about girls. You're talking about cars. You're talking about clothes. And I'm like, yo, I want to dictate that conversation with our magazine.
Did you leave XXL to do King?
Nah, it was a crazy run. Real quick run through, just to
yeah, we need to
real quick run through. Yeah. I'm gonna do it quick. Intern started as an intern at Vibe Magazine, stayed there for a year. Found out about XXL, a whole host of events. I ended up coming in on the first issue with Jay-Z and Master P on the cover. Started making my name there. Was associate music editor for 2 years there. Bounced from there. Diddy and all of them, they started this thing called Hook.com. It was like kind of like the first kind of karma loop. It was content, mm-hmm, hip-hop mm-hmm. content with e-commerce.
That's dope.
Yeah, the internet bubble burst. Boom. Bounced from there. As that was going down, before I left XXL, I pitched the idea for King. And I also like this car magazine. The publishers remembered that. They reached out to me. They was like, yo, why don't you come back and do that King joint?
That's dope.
Did that. Started that in 2001. Did that up until like 2009. Russell came and got me and was like, yo, help me with
Global Grind.
Mm-hmm. Did Global Grind for like, let's see, like 9 months, almost 10, was running around everywhere with him. He put me in rooms that was so crazy. Like, it still blows my mind to this day. I learned so much from him. From there, I went back to Vibe. I became editor-in-chief for XXL, too, while at Harris. When I started King, Rides, all that, I became I forgot about that. I started the whole freshman issue joint. All of that.
XXL, yeah, we got to get to that. There's a couple of things. Listen, we can't. Go ahead.
Bring us
to today.
So then, boom, bounced from there. Went to Vibe. Did Vibe from 2010, 2013. 2013 to 2015, I was doing Respect Magazine.
Yep, Respect.
And Ozzy, the other joint I was telling y'all about. And then Vibe called me back, 2015. Been there since.
So you always leave on good terms, clearly.
But yeah, like I'm
I
good
be
with
cursing
everybody.
People out.
Yeah,
I can
you be
never
knocking
come
shit out.
Back.
Knocking stuff down on the
oh,
way out.
I can never come back. I realize I'm 50 Cent. Like, don't nobody want to hire me. I'm going to have to make it my own.
We're going to get into when we come back from the break, into some of the things because you can't just run past that. But one thing I want to tell the internets, and which is amazing, and which I'm proud of you and which I admire you is you started off by saying I was an intern at Vibe.
No
That's
doubt.
Right.
No doubt.
It's, what a journey it is because
I'm telling you,
think about it. Think about a person. Listen, when you wake up and think about it, any music journalist, anybody who wants to write for a living, anyone who wants to do what they
Even
love
these new bloggers.
For a living. Yeah, new blog. But keep in mind, think about this. Imagine being an intern at a company and then one day being the editor-in-chief.
It's crazy. It's wild.
We're going to get to that, the feelings of that, everything. Internets, listen, don't go nowhere. Grab yourself
a pen and a pad because y'all new age internets have this sense of entitlement, but this man started as an intern and grew, so y'all got to have to take some notes.
And some people pull out your iPhone, get your notes out.
No, write it down. Write it down because that's different. What if your phone battery dies?
Pen and paper's official. Change your life. Pen and paper's official. Internets, don't go nowhere. We'll be right back. Cheer.
Al.
Internets, I'm excited. Lissa?
I can see. You got the sweatpants on?
Yeah, you can know. I got
it. Ow. He internet. Excited. Internet.
Live 1 year anniversary Premium Pete Show. Miss Lissa Knowles will be there doing her goddamn thing.
Got that right.
Okay. Special guest coming. Past guest coming.
Free liquor might be coming.
DJ Ted Smoot on the 1 and 2s.
That sounds so dope.
Listen, sponsored by UN Athletics. We got a bunch of giveaways to give away. Snacks, beverages. And you know where it's going to be at? At that dope WeWork Soho location.
The Soho, the private space?
Listen, that shit is official tissue. 7 to 11. Listen.
And the real 7 to 11, not the black 7 to 11. So
no,
be on
7
time.
7 to 11. Listen, I want you to RSVP at PPSRSVP@gmail.com.
That's easy.
What's it? PPSRSVP@gmail.com. Premium Pete Show 1 year anniversary. It's going to be litty. Okay,
Liddy in New York City.
Make sure
so
you
pull
be
out
there.
Them titties and make sure you look pretty.
Listen, mark
like
your calendars. Mark
me.
Your calendars. We'll see you there, man. I want to give you a hug. I'm gonna have some pizza for some folks.
Yeah.
And Oreos. See you there. Internet. This episode is sponsored by the College of Hip Hop.
That's right.
Let me tell you something. I've been getting so many people hit me up about, yo, Pete, I heard you talk about this College of Hip Hop. I downloaded the app. I fuck with it. It's official, and I'm glad that we're able to put somebody on, because let me tell you something. It's not about them only sponsoring. It's about you guys learning
right. That
there's shit out there to expand your mind. You
open
know?
Up your mind, Craig.
They got interviews.
Whether you got a GED, a PhD, or you down with OPP, this is the information station to be.
Exactly. They got interviews. They got, you know, publications. They got all information.
Templates for some contracts. They're going to answer all of your need-to-know questions in this music industry.
Stop fucking around. Just go download the College of Hip Hop
app. And don't be trying
today.
To call your homeboy who the producer
you don't need
who
that.
Over there. You just need this app.
Go get the
How
app.
How much it costs?
$3.99.
Get the woo out of here.
College of Hip Hop app. Download that today. Tell them Premium Pete Show sent you.
And if you can, give me some bundles while you're at it.
Cheer.
Thank you.
Internet, and we're back sitting with the one and only Datwon Thomas.
What up?
Listen, Datwon, it's funny because before we went on break, you went, you know, over like some of your accolades.
Uh-huh.
Or basically, you took us through a journey. It only took like a minute or two. But think about that shit. It's been 20 years.
It's wild to me, man.
And some of the things that I want you to go over, when you spoke about Russell and how you seemed thankful.
Yeah.
Like he put you in spots that, you know, that amazed you.
Yeah.
Can you speak about some of the, you know, maybe a moment that you remember that really, you know, had you?
Or how did you meet him, or, you know?
Oh, wow. Like, you know, like with everybody else, man, everybody looked at Russell as like
the blueprint.
He's the blueprint. That's what we call him. We call him the blueprint. You know what I'm saying? Or at least I do. And I think most people.
Puff. I've heard him call that
you know
a lot.
I mean? Oh, yes.
Pipe down.
The bottle game is serious.
Oh, yes. See, because y'all knew my friend was coming.
All right, that's what's up.
Ow.
I think, like, I always wanted to work with Russell. Ever since, this is going to sound crazy, but ever since, like, seeing Crush Groove and understanding that, oh, this is his story, this is this guy's story, and being able to see that he was, like, the person that went from making records to clothing and publishing and all of that stuff. You know what I'm saying? And yes. Thank you.
Internet's we're getting around the wine. Red wine. But yeah, you know, I mean, just it's I mean, not everyone every day gets a chance to move around with Russell Simmons.
Nah, man.
You know, I mean,
it's rare. I the one thing I would say is that, you know, he'll put you in position and then you gotta hustle. You know what I mean?
Sure.
He's not
like
gonna,
it should be.
He's going to lead you to the water, but he ain't going to teach you how to fish.
Exactly.
I will say it's always who you know. Yeah. You know what I mean? But then it's like what you do once you get there.
Yep.
You know, like knowing someone could help out. But you still have to, you know, I'm going to give an old school quote, make your own bones.
All day. And the one thing that I learned from him is seeing how he dealt with adversity and companies like maybe not doing as well. And how do you fix it? He didn't always just jump out of something. It was like, all right, we got to get it right, and then we fix it, then you flip it. Mm. And if you look at his career, you look at his you know, his track record, it's a lot of wins, man.
Yeah.
When it should be losses. Mm-hmm. Or other people would have just chalked it up as a loss. And I'm sure he's had his share of failures or things that, you know, he considers that. But I always looked at it like, wow, man, this dude finds a way to make it win. And he's always energetic about that. So that was some of the things that I took away from my time with him.
Do you have one memorable moment that sticks out to you?
We went to Silicon Valley one time. Mm-hmm. And Silicon Valley.
Oh, no. Ain't that what they call it?
Nah. that's Silicon
Valley.
Yeah,
she really showed her New York side on that one.
Silicon Valley.
Listen, you actually want to be in Silicon Valley because you know, you pull up wearing, letting them thighs out like that. You may be set for life.
What you call those?
Thunder thighs? Jort boots.
Jort boots.
Anthony, you're seeing the pictures.
Y'all seeing
the pictures.
But one of the things that I remember, we went out to meet with the people from Facebook, guys that invest in them. And I had to put this deck together. And we were presenting like the global grind vision and all this stuff. And Russell was going to go ahead and knock that out. So we get into the meeting and I forgot like my little dress shoes. So I had to wear my Jordan 3s.
Okay. And, which I can really consider dress shoes.
Right. But it was still like I was kind of dressy, but I had these Jordan 3s on because I forgot my shit. I was like, I can't fucking believe this shit. So I walk into the joint with them. You know Russ. He got a bubble vest, checkered shirt, Yankee hat, jeans, shell toes. So we walk in there. He's doing his talk. He's being Russell.
Right.
It's like 8 different rich people just on the other side. And then he was like, yeah, Datwon got it from here. Go ahead, Dave. And I'm just like, like, what? Russell? He was like, yeah, he's up next. Go ahead, man. And I'm like, okay.
Did you grab it and get it together?
Got it together. The slides was there because I knew all the stuff. And he knew what he needed to do. And then he knew what I needed to do.
Right.
And in that moment, I learned a lot about myself. Because regardless of everything that I had done up until that point, all these mags and all this stuff, all these different things, it was still like, yo, you got to prove yourself every time you're on the court. You can't just think about those old, what Babe Ruth said? Old home runs. Yesterday's home runs don't win today's game.
Exactly, right. Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So when you like, oh, man, I did X, Y, and Z, that's good. But at the same time, how are you performing today?
I mean, listen, Russell put you in a position where you really had to learn on, like, just jump out there and, like, you know,
you
improv, right?
Yeah, you got to do it. And luckily, you know, I knew the stuff well enough to be able to convey what we were trying to get across, was like, yo, we need some money.
Does Russell curse in his meetings?
He curse everywhere.
He cursed everywhere.
Yeah.
Everywhere.
But you know what? You know, what's great about Russell, I think, you know, besides all his other contributions that he has given to the game, one thing I like about him is that he, you know when they say you pay to be the boss?
Yeah.
You know, like he's been always able to be himself. No. Like when you sit there and you say, like, where, you know, where sneakers, where, you know, where shell, you know, where superstars.
And I was worried about that when in that story about my Jordan 3s.
Yeah. Meanwhile,
And then when I was leaving, two of the dudes hit me and was like, yo, those sneakers are high. I wish we could go to meetings like that.
Yeah.
And I was like, damn, man, I left my shoes.
Right.
Yeah. You know, Russell, that's his uniform.
And listen, you know, that goes to show that, you know, being your own boss.
Your authentic self.
Exactly.
Your authentic self.
And that's what Russell Simmons is.
All the way.
You know, there's so many other things we're going to go into as far as, like, you know, your career. One thing I want to go right into this right now is that I've been thinking about it. And when I knew you were going to come on the show, I was like, yo, I got to ask you this.
Yep.
For music journalists, for people who want to be in this business, for kids right now that like to write, there's a lot of writers out there.
Yeah.
It's a struggle.
Yeah.
You know, and I want to tell you my opinion of it. Even watching the sneaker blogs over the years and this and stuff, I met people who had great followings, big blogs. They would want to sleep on my couch.
Yeah.
You know, they were rock stars, but, you know, to other people, but the grind, it looked beautiful, but it was a big struggle.
That's the point
I'm trying to make to you is people listen to this, okay, that want to get into the music business, that want to get into publishing and magazine and digital, whatever the fuck they want to get in. How do they get in, and how do they succeed?
They cannot stop. You can't stop doing what you think is going to get you there. If it's going out, networking, you think that's going to get you there? Cool. That's one aspect. Is it working on your craft, trying to find out, you know, the best ways to write and what people are gravitating towards? That's one way. Are you working on video? You know, do you have a podcast? You have to have all these different extensions of who you are as an individual brand before you even step into someone's company now.
Right.
You know, when I was coming up and I wanted to be an intern, I just wanted to get into the brand so I could learn.
Sure.
I didn't get your foot in the door. Get my foot in the door, then I'll work everything else out. You know what I mean? And that was the struggle to do that. Now, you got to come as a package,
sure,
but willing to learn. You have to come with some kind of skill set, but willing to learn. And I think most people come in now, most of the young kids may come in now and like, I'm the boss, or, you know, you
want
might
a big
not,
check.
Yeah, you owe, B, you owe, you right. owe. Like, that's their thing now. You owe, let us in. And it's like, well, you know, our experience got us here. You know, there's something that and we could talk about it. It's something that Joey Badass just did.
Just on hot.
Yeah.
Told him to sit down.
Told him like, yo, it's
all
time,
of them.
It's time for the newbies. But if you listen closely, you hear Ebro like, nah, but you gotta take it from me.
Right.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, Ebro's like, nah, you gotta take, because coming up, you had to take it from somebody or let them know that
sure,
you was
sure, that
like,
you were nice enough.
That you was nice enough. Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But it would be nice for them to groom some people.
No, the grooming aspect, I think, needs to happen across the board. And I'm one of the biggest proponents of that.
No, you a groomer. We
you know
not,
what I'm
don't
saying?
About
All
it.
The way
you
across, there's so many people that, you know, I talk to on a daily and help them with their situations and stuff
all
like
the time.
That. And you know, we fam though. So that aspect I understand. But as far as like moving over to just let somebody
right.
in, that's going to be the harder part to do, because you're like,
why?
Yo, I worked.
Yeah,
massive hours to get here. Mm-hmm. I'm going to have to either be pushed out or I'm going to groom the next person that's going to be able to help my situation
right.
too. You know what I'm saying? So the conflict there is, I think the younger generation is looking at it like, y'all don't respect us. That whole talk is a respect talk.
Mm.
Once some of the older generation respects the younger generation, then you can start to see the commingling of them coming in to slots. Right now, it seems like the older heads just don't respect and are hating, so that's why they're being set up.
It kind of also feels like this new generation has a sense of entitlement, though. Like, it's one thing to demand respect, and it's another thing to earn it. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't feel like they're earning it. I don't feel like they're just
well, not everybody. Some people
because they have this following or because this song. Instead of
well,
like,
the followings. That's a popularity contest,
right?
At mm-hmm. the end of the day, does your following constitute your quality?
Right.
Does that match up? That's all I care. You can have the 28 million people following you throughout all your platforms, but does your quality really speak to them? Or
sure.
are you just a hot, cool person?
Or do
in high
they
school?
Believe they believe in what you're speaking, you know?
Right.
You know, do you handle the hiring right now of
yes, indeed.
Okay. Who's the last person? I don't want to say last person. Uh-huh. What position is the last that you hired? You know, like, have you hired a writer recently?
Yes, yes.
And what
yes.
do you look for?
The main thing I'm looking for is someone that has like a tireless work ethic.
Mm-hmm.
You might not even be the best writer, but if you have like one of those work ethics that, yo, I'm trying to get this done, I want to make sure that this is right, I'm willing to learn. That's one of the things that I really look for, someone that's willing to learn and listen. Because a lot of times people don't realize that they can't listen, yo.
Mm.
Yo, if you can't listen, you're not learning.
Mm. Most people, you know, the problem is most people, they're not listening. They're just getting ready to talk. They're not listening to you. So,
nope.
you know, so they're just waiting to respond.
Right.
Yeah.
So they're not giving full attention.
Nah,
you know?
And one of the things with that is some people just be talking a lot of bullshit, so they don't want to hear nothing.
Right.
You know, I know my way. But when you're in a work environment or a setting where skill is being taught, Or you have a chance to absorb that skill, that's when you chill out.
Right.
That's when you chill out and you kind of observe, ask your questions, you know, a little bit of humble pie, and it'll take you a long way. Mm. All you got to do is listen, y'all. That's
and pay
it.
Attention. That's pay why you have two eyes, two ears, and one mouth.
That's
now,
real.
Now you know, the just from me watching and I'm some of the internet's watching, journalists or, you know, people within, you know, publication like that, whether it be magazine or online, you know, like I said, it's a struggle, and it's not. People look at it like, you know, you get to go to events, you get to meet these artists. But again, like I always tell people think like, you know, success equates to money. It doesn't do that. It doesn't equate to big money.
It doesn't. Not,
you know, you
not
look at somebody even like Mikey Fresh.
Yeah, that's
this
my
kid's been grinding for a long time.
That's my Bayesian.
Yeah, and I like that you call him Bayesian.
I told him I was coming. He was like, yo, you going to tell my boo what
that's
up?
Bayesian.
Now,
about to have a little
even somebody like him, you know, it seems to be like, you know, like he seems to be, to me, an authentic guy.
I'm going to tell you right now. Mm-hmm. I'm going to tell you right now. I probably wouldn't even be back at Vibe if not for Mikey Fresh.
Mm-hmm.
For him being like, yo, Day, what up? Let's get the band back together again. Mm-hmm. That's one individual within this game that I love like a brother.
Mm-hmm.
Rob Markman is mm-hmm. another one. He's just incredibly
definitely you know, another dude that is a good dude.
Oh, no question. Like the qualities that they both inhibit within this game, they're stand up guys, they understand street culture, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. they understand corporate
respectful.
Culture. Super respectful, and respected.
Yes, yes.
Know their hip hop shit and then have visions of how things should look going forward. That's what I love about those two guys. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And it's been a pleasure and an honor to work with both of them mm-hmm. in the capacities that I have. With Rob Markman, he was in my music department when I was editor-in-chief of XXL.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we was crafting the whole freshman joint. And then me and Mikey over at Vibe since like 2010 or something like that.
Now you were the reason that XXL, you know, well, not XXL, but freshman, you know, started doing the XXL freshman cover. Right?
Yeah, and it's always like speculation on when and where and all that. This is it right here. So basically, before I became editor in chief, Elliot Wilson was editor.
Shout out to Elliot.
Yeah, love El.
Now, do you have a great relationship with Elliot?
Great relationship with Elliot.
Tell you one, don't you have a great relationship with?
It's a couple of people, but Elliot, me and him, we 100. And what's crazy is it was like a healthy competition up at Harris because you had so many different magazines with different editor in chiefs.
Right.
So as I'm doing King and I'm trying to get it. It was this Rolling Stone article where they were comparing all the Def Jam execs. So
right.
They had like Dame Dash and Irv Gotti and all of them. And they was talking about being the hottest nigga in the building. And I mean, to be real, that's what we were all trying to do. My man Jerry Barrow was doing Scratch. I had my man Ben was doing Slam. Elliot's doing XXL. I got King and Rods, and we all just trying to do it. Me and Elliot, we ended up doing a magazine together called Hip Hop Soul, mm-hmm. where we put hip-hop and R&B together as a joke at first. It was
right.
a joke that we would say, and it ended up becoming a successful
genre.
Yeah, a successful magazine.
But
then he did this one cover, Leaders of the New School,
mm-hmm.
where it was like Boozy, Papoose, Crooked Eye,
mm.
Saigon, all of them. It was a bunch of, it was like 10 cats. They all had on white jackets. And it was called Leaders of the New School. I was told that cover didn't necessarily do well, but I loved the concept.
Right.
Because we used to do something in King very similar before that came out called Coming Kings, where we would say these are the people within any genre that's going to be big this year.
Right.
So we were already doing something like that. So then when I became editor-in-chief at the LF, I remember saying like, yo, you know what? I want to bring that, but I'm going to put like this marketing package behind it. And I'm going to flip it. So then that's when we went and got Asher Roth, Kid Cudi, B.O.B., who else, man? Wale. We had Corey Guns. We had everybody on the
And Ace those Hood. Are all the people that came out of the XXL freshman.
Yeah, on that real first freshman.
On the beginning
one.
Of
yeah.
creating it. Yeah.
Right. Like, Leaders of the New School was that
Cudi.
One. But then
huh?
Cudi, all of them.
Yeah.
So then Currency.
Really?
Yeah, I had all of them, man. Mickey Fax, my bro.
Now let me ask something. Do any of these artists like appreciate that was done for them?
Yeah.
You ever see them and they say like, "Yo,
it's
thanks
so
for
funny."
That,
I was in LA recently, okay. not this trip, but in January, and I hadn't seen B.O.B. in a long time, and I was like, "Yo, B.O.B., I know you don't know me, but I'm Datwon, I was editor in chief. I put you on the cover for it." He was like, "Yo," he was bugging. He was like, "Yo, that's crazy. I remember we had a good time. It was dope. Very appreciative." Wale and I, we haven't talked, but Kid Cudi, everybody else, I'm pretty much like cool with. But the funny thing about the whole freshman thing was, even though supposedly it didn't do as well before in that iteration, I was like, yo, let's make everybody do freestyles, but you can't see their face. So you don't know who's going to be, who this is. So we found, you know, like creative ways on letting the rappers rhyme without seeing their face. Like Kid Cudi had his Bape hoodie zipped up and he rhyming.
Oh, that's hot.
Blue, who I had on the cover, he had his back turned, but you couldn't see what, you know, who it was. You saw the feet. Oh, I think Currency had a bandana around his face and he's rhyming. So it garnered this like this mystery, like, yo, who are these dudes?
Right.
You know what I mean? And this is a funny story too. At the time, some of the blogs was just coming up, and one of the blogs got it early. Got like
what they, blog is that?
I can't. I ain't even going to do it. I ain't even going to kill them like that. But they good people. They good people. And they ended up. They ended up posting something early, and people got to see like maybe the first three of the artists. Right. And I was heated. I called. And I was like, yo, what the fuck? And
did you find out who the leak was?
Yeah, they took it down, found out the leak and everything. It was all fan, but it was like, yo, we want to keep this as something special. Everything isn't for like mass consumption before it comes out.
Right.
Let's have some element of surprise and make people think. And I wanted to go back to that. Nowadays, it's so hard to do that.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I got to give it to Vanessa Satin. She's been able to keep it going for so long and infuse.
And they promote it very well when it comes around. It's became a holiday for them.
That's the thing that keeps the business going.
Yeah, yeah.
I was like, yo, we're going to make this a concert series. We're going to add, we had a mixtape for it with DJ Who Kid. It was like all these different components that I saw for it that we were able to execute. And then now look at it. It's like, it's super huge. And it's a linchpin in the culture.
Right.
Kids want to be a freshman now. You know what I mean? Regardless of how much they say they don't, if you get that call, you're doing it.
Right.
You know what I mean? So yeah, that's one of the great
That
great
was like
things.
One of your babies. Do you still feel like connected to it, or did you just let it go and just let it grow?
I think you got to let it go and let it grow. You know what I'm saying?
And it evolves.
Yeah, it evolves and it gets bigger. And I love seeing what it is. And people hit me, you know, like around the time that people that know,
right?
Who you got? I'm like, oh, that's a dope list. There's been lists that I wasn't feeling.
Like, try to pay you to be on.
What do you mean?
Like payola? Like I'll give you some money if you put this person on.
Brown paper bag?
Oh hell yeah! What?
They're trying to become a college basketball player.
You know what I'm saying? Like, that's happened. But nah, the one thing I always tell artists is, like, don't do that. Not artists, writers.
Yeah.
Don't do that. Because then you get known for that.
Compromise your integrity.
Yeah.
Speaking of writers, you ever get writer's block or a lack of inspiration?
Hell yes.
How the fuck do you power through that?
I try to find inspiration, mainly through music. Mm. I try to find. Like, before, when I was first writing, I used to, my wife and my little sister, Co, what up, Co? They used to see me, pardon me, I would put on Chico DeBarge.
Mm-hmm.
I would put album on. The first album, I think it was like Trouble Man, all that. I would put on D'Angelo. I'll put on J Dilla, which I still do to this day. If I get real heavy writer's block, I'll put on some J Dilla. But then, like, I was having, like a low inspiration point, like, just a couple of weeks ago. And I went to LA this past week. Man, that sunshine, Venice Beach, you know, riding around, like good energy, good weather.
Woke you right the fuck up.
I was spitting out ideas. Like, yo, we could do X, Y. Yo, I came back to New York like, yo, I'm ready. And we sometimes you just need to get away from your everyday routine.
Yeah.
Switch it up so other things can attract to you. And I've always said to people, You gotta go find inspiration sometime. Go where it is. You know what I mean? You might not know where it is, but go where that is.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Find that shit. Find it. Because if not, you're going to wallow in despair. You're going to start feeling down on yourself. You start like, oh, man, this shit ain't working. In New York, weather lately has been so up and down. It puts people in these funny-ass moods.
Yep.
And I'm not saying Cali weather is the best, but it was what I needed to wake me up to get me motivated. You know what I'm saying?
What woke you up and got you motivated to even reach out to get the internship? Like, did you know, like, how did you go about it? Like,
it was wild. I used to tell my mom and my cousin L, happy birthday, L. I used to tell them that I was going to work there. My mom always knew I was
at Vibe.
At Vibe, yeah. Like, that was a thing. Every month it came out, I was copping. I was in high school. My favorite writer was Kevin Powell, Rob Marriott. There's so many, man. Dream Hampton.
Mm-hmm.
This is a ghetto communicator. Mm. I used to read all their pieces in the Source and Double XL. I mean, Source and Vibe. And I was like, it was just something about Vibe that that was a little bit more universal. You know, they were going for it. You know, they would put George Clinton on the cover.
Right.
You know what I mean? And I just was like, I'm going to do it. So I was in college, failed the math test. I was in the computer lab. I had like 50 cent on me. I took a quarter. I saw on the internet that they were looking for interns. I called the number. Dude picked up. I was like, yo, I need to work there. I can do whatever. He was like, yo, come on a Saturday. There's going to be 300 people there. I was like, 300
what
people?
What the fuck? Wait, this is on a phone call?
This is on a phone call.
Yo, that had to be the funniest. Like,
yeah.
Hello?
It was like
vibe.
That.
Yeah.
Vibe. How may I help you? What do you say?
I was like, yo, I just saw that you guys posted up that you need interns. I'm down for it. You know, anything I need to do, where do I need to be? And dude was like, yo, you got to come to the office. It's going to be 300 people, though. It's going to be mad competitive. So, you know, I wish you luck, but come to this address. I was like, I bet. It was around my birthday time in May. So I go on a Saturday. I go, the security guard looks at me and he's like, ain't no 300 people here. Ain't nobody here. This I was like, yo, I was crushed. But back then we had the little beepers and stuff. And I had the number that I called in my beeper. So I went to the corner and I called the number on my beeper, like, yo, this dude finessed me. You know what I'm saying? Like, this ain't even real. Right. 300 people. I called the number. He picked up. He was like, yo, Vibe. I was like, oh, yo, this dude, I was just there. They told me ain't nobody there. And he was like, nah, I just got in. Like, yo, where you at? I'm like, I'm at the corner. And he looked out the window and he saw me. He waved me up. He was like, yo, just come again. I was like, I bet. I walk in. The security guard was like, yo, you walked out. He walked in. And I was like, yeah, whatever, dude.
Right.
Whatever. So then I get upstairs and the lobby at Vibe was on Lexington and like 31st or 32nd. The lobby was so dope. They had the mags. It was like a little purple tint. It felt like I was in like one of those ill, you know, New Jack Swing videos. This is 96, you know what I'm saying? So they had the spiral staircase with the chandeliers and everybody's office. It was sexy, man. I was like, and everybody had their nameplates. And then I saw Kevin Powell's name on one of the doors. I was like, yo, this is his office?
Right.
I was bugging. And he's a really good friend of mine now. Like, it bugs me out to even
But that doesn't this. that doesn't surprise me, because again, you were an intern at Vibe,
yeah,
who became editor in chief. That shit doesn't just happen.
But though, it's wild. Like when you think about being
people
on the
you
outside,
look up to?
Yeah, people
become
you look up
your
to
friends.
Exactly, but when you're on the outside of this game, like everybody that's listening, and you're on the outside of this game, I know that feeling. You know what I'm saying?
You know what? You know
that
what?
Feeling is just it's the best and the worst.
Yeah.
Because you feel like they're never going to let me in. And then when you get in, it's like you start ping-ponging around, and it's like, oh, dip, I'm rubbing elbows with the people that inspire me.
Right.
And then next thing you know, you're competing.
Or doing things and being friends, you know what I mean? And then creating things together.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's funny because I think a lot of us don't take time to respect the moments. A lot of people say, when I get there, I'll celebrate. You may never get there.
I remember Kanye said something about that. I think he was like, yo, we got to celebrate now.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? I don't know if he still feels that way, but that's how I felt. I mean, even just to cap it off, when I got upstairs and I was looking around, I was like, yo, where the 300 people? And he was like, word. I was like, yeah, I was waiting for like crowds and shit. He was like, nah, I just said that because I didn't want nobody up here that was going to be scared.
Yeah, I like that. I like
that's
that.
Not,
yo, that just taught me. That moment taught me so much more. That moment is the reason why I feel like I've been able to endure so much, because I'm like, yo, just show up.
And I think you
just
know,
show up and you got it. Dave.
I think that's like, you know, that's half the battle.
It is
just
man.
Showing up and just being there, just putting yourself in position.
Right.
And this is the other thing. When you say it like that, I think people don't realize you're gonna be scared as hell showing up. You're going to be scared. You're going to be like, oh, man. Or you're going to be like me,
yeah,
who didn't have anything to lose,
yeah,
and not be scared. It's all opportunity. So however you feel, if you scared or not, show up. If you late, show up. Just be like, yo, I'm sorry. Just be there.
Yeah, I'm blaming your baby daddy
here.
And his
I'm
new
here.
Girlfriend in the car.
I'll tell you one thing. One thing that I think that as we speak about, you know, remembering moments and applauding the journey,
uh-huh,
and just taking time out to, you know, where you could just really, I guess, applaud your small victories.
Yeah.
There's nothing wrong with doing that.
Yo, you got to, man. And I think we deprive ourselves by doing that as we get jaded in the game. There was
yeah.
a point where I wasn't celebrating the wins. I wasn't looking at them. And then I let that opportunity go. And now I'm looking back on it. I was like, damn, that was pretty significant. And, you know, we ain't pop a bottle on that. But for the most part, with King, and especially my King years, because I had such a dope team over there. King, my King staff was the dopest joint, man. It was like all my friends. It was like the time where the one guy was able to get all his friends together and have the craziest party for like 8 years. you have an 8 year party.
It's like a
man.
College dorm room party for yo, years. Damn.
And you just get to do it every month. You just going and going and.
And that's success.
Love, man.
That's being able to do that for that long. Bro, you know what? You know what? You really, like, you struck a chord in me just now, just, like, thinking. Like, you know how you spoke about, like, Kevin Powell, and now he's, like, a really good friend of yours.
Yeah.
Or you think about you being an intern and then becoming the editor-in-chief.
Right.
You know, even, sometimes, I always talk about financial just because I always want to be in a better place, but I can never forget about the victories that I created for myself. You know, I think about it, like growing up, like, man, Ghetto Boys was, a shit, man. You know, my mom.
You gotta love that shit.
Yo, this week, Halloween falls on a weekend is all I used to talk about.
You gotta love that.
Scarface is on dial anytime. My car speaks all
crazy?
The time.
Yo, you know what's even crazier? And my family could attest to this. Like, everybody that's super close has seen me grow up. Q-Tip and Tribe Called Quest was like my... Q-Tip, Big Daddy Kane, Kwame. Exactly, Kwame. I just love Kwame. I was a Kwame fanatic.
Polka Dot motherfucker.
Polka Dot, yeah. KRS-One, Coochie Rap, all of them.
The God.
It was so crazy for me to meet Q-Tip and be like, yo, you know, I admire your work and all of that stuff. And then to be able to do business with him, talk to him on a regular, like hearing it just bugs me out, man.
Yeah.
Like, it was one of those things that I was like, yo, this is crazy.
That's how I feel about you.
Stop it.
No, because I see you on like television doing like commentary on like certain like shows and stuff. And like, that's how I feel.
I think
like,
she's
to
coming
be able
for you.
To call,
nah,
like,
talk to your wife.
Yo, and like be like, oh my God, I need like advice, and I can like go
you know what's
to
so
the
crazy
office.
About her? She knows that, like, what now? Like 2 years now, we've been having you come back and forth to Vibe.
Mm-hmm.
Yep, doing a couple of things.
Doing a couple of things with us, and her couple of things have been hits.
Mm-mm.
And I'm like, yo, I just want to give somebody a chance that I see that yo, amazing talent. She's about to kill it.
Yeah,
Williams, all that craziness. Like, and Pete, for you to even bring her on here and have her in the spot, that shows that you see it as well.
Yeah, when I thought of Miss Lissa, you know, it's funny because when I thought of her to come on the show and do it with me.
We ain't do that though.
Well, no, it's funny because it's like
I was waiting for you. Yo, y'all was waiting for her too, right?
Yeah, I knew she was gonna say
you
that.
Know she was gonna say something.
But I wanted someone who, first of all, she's very witty and I love witty people.
Super.
You know, and I think you always want to be on your feet, man. And I think that, you know, she's a homegirl.
Yeah.
Real talk. And it's cool.
See that girl that you call when a girl try to play
exactly.
You like, yo, I'm gonna get my cousin.
I'm definitely
you call
her.
Lissa.
And
I'm definitely her.
It's cool to have that. So I definitely, you know, like I said, I definitely saw that I could be myself around her and then also debate with her. And because I just didn't want no yes woman.
Right.
You know, that was just happy to be here. You
it's,
know?
It's ill what y'all have built, though.
Yeah.
Because when you struck out on your own, I'm sure you had doubters. I'm sure you doubted.
Yeah. Let me
tell
you something.
Like, look at what y'all built. What episode are we on?
Man, this is like 54.
54. That's a good number. And plus, I'm the start of the new season. I like that.
Okay.
Yeah. I was just playing.
No, 53.
53. No, it's 54.
54, okay.
54. But you know what? You know, and that's another thing, too. You know, I don't want to get off topic, but I appreciate, you know, first of all, anytime I've seen you out in these streets, you always appreciate what I was doing.
Yep.
Anything that I contributed. At the same time, I appreciated what you contributed.
Appreciate
And you definitely, you know, even before I hit you up to come on, you have wrote to me multiple times that you like seeing me shining out here.
I see you.
And yeah, exactly. Yep. And first of all, I just want to let you know that I appreciate that.
That's love, bro.
And those all little day. Things, not real talk, those little things help people, man.
Yeah.
You know, I do that for other people. You do that for me. Like, you know, it's funny. Like, I've been learning a lot. Like I'll do something for somebody.
Yeah.
And, you know, and something that they couldn't do for themselves.
Yep.
May not be, maybe big, maybe small. And they're like, yo, how can I ever repay you?
Yeah.
And you know what I've been doing? Instead of saying, like, I'll take $500 or I'll take, you know, I know you, I just say, like, yo, you know what? I need you to do something for me. And they'll say what? And I'll say, do what I did for you for somebody else.
Yeah.
You know what's so crazy, man? Like, my favorite book my favorite book in the whole world is Man Child in the Promised Land by Claude Brown. You know, he writes about his life as a youngster growing into adulthood in Harlem in like 1950s, 60s. It's my favorite book. And in it, he says that you gotta feed the birds. And meaning you gotta take what you can give when people ask to help them get to whatever. So when he would be in the street and he had money on him and, you know, a homeless person would ask him for some paper, boom, he's putting into that good karma thing. It's not like you gotta do it, but it's just something helping somebody.
Right.
And yesterday, this dude, as I'm getting my Metro card to go to work, this dude rolled up on me. He looked crazy. Everybody was like staying away from him. And I had my headphones on, and he was like kind of mouthing to me. I was like, yo, what up? He was like, yo, I just need one quarter. One quarter. That's all I need.
And you know, I would have responded on a jokey side. Yeah, I would have been like, what the fuck? You're going to open up a business
like
with that
quarter? Like, what are you getting? You getting a Bazooka Joe or something? Yeah. Like, I don't even know how much them shit is anymore.
What'd you say to him?
Hot cheese popcorn.
Yo, so I... and... I didn't have any change. All I had was like bigger bills. So I was like, you know what? Yo, here, I had so much like fun and everything in LA. And I was thinking about the book when you got to feed, you know, a transfer. So
could have been a sign.
Could have been a sign. Like how much a dollar costs, Kendrick Lamar. That could be God.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And I think he was, at first I was about to say no. And then I was like, oh, wait. I do have something. Like, boom, I gave him a bigger bill. This man looked at me and was like, man, you shitting me? Like
you made his day.
Like, yo, you just gave, are you serious? Like, he gave me the are you serious look. And then he was trying to go in for the hug. I was like, high five, bro. High five, high five, though.
Yeah. I'm
about to give you
a finger nails.
That's about, let's do a high five. And I say that to say, like, you gotta feed into the less fortunate or people that are at a different level. And I'm not saying I'm better than anybody. I could easily be in that position.
Sure.
But it's the fact that I had it to give, and sometimes you got to do that. And some people will look at that as like, oh, you soft or you corny or you this or you too giving. Because earlier you said, and I get this a lot, B. I get this a lot. Why are you so nice?
Yeah.
I used to get this in the early.
It's not a disrespect thing.
Yeah. It's because there's a positivity that comes from me.
Sure.
And I'm aware
of
it.
And you let that off.
Now I'm aware of it. Before I wasn't. So when people used to say, I'm like, yo, they think that it can't happen? Or like a fight won't go down? Like, yeah, dude, you know what I'm saying? Like, yo, I ain't soft, bitch.
Smack
like,
a motherfucker.
Yeah, like, yo, don't play.
Right.
But just because I don't want that energy and I'm ready because I know I got different things to lift off to, I'm that because I don't want that energy coming back.
Right. And
I don't need that.
You need good karma.
You need that. I got daughters, B.
Yeah.
I need every protective, positive thing to protect them. That's what I do that for.
Listen, motherfucking exactly. I say it all the time. There was a girl, I remember when I just had my daughter and me and her mother separated. There was a girl that, she was like, I love you. I love you. I want to be with you forever. And I was like, I do not care about this girl.
Right.
So I was like, yo. And she was like, so she had called me, and my daughter was a couple, and I just got off the phone. My daughter's like, I love you, daddy. I'm going to bed. I was like, I love you, and I'll call you tomorrow. And then this girl had texted me, and she was like, you know, come over and fuck me.
Yo.
So I called her up, and I was like, hey. And she's like, hey, you going to come over? She's like, I can't wait to suck your dick. And I swear to God. And I was like, you know, that's just how, you know, we had that
relationship. He's sharing the day. He's sharing the night.
No. And I just turned around, and I was like, look, I'm not going to come there.
Wow.
And then she was like, what do you mean? I was like, look, I'm going to be honest with you. You could find someone better than me. I really don't like you like that.
Wow.
You said that like real.
I swear to God.
Extra blunt?
No, I'm explaining to you why. I told you because all I could think about was my daughter.
Yeah.
And I was like, yo, if a guy, don't get me wrong, not that a guy, I couldn't stop it from happening. It could still happen to her. But I was like, yo, think about what I'm doing to this girl. Yeah. I already had enough girls. I didn't need to do that to this girl. And I'll be honest with you, a lot of girls, us as men, and sometimes we don't think, fuck a bitch, leave him, tap him on the head, peace, bitch, jeez, thanks for the head, thanks for the pussy. You don't think about, some people may do that. Think about that. I've been a guy who just came over, fuck one girl one day, another girl later on that day, another girl. Not even thinking that when their feelings matter.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, yeah. Like, and some of these girls are like, maybe I'm, like, think about it. We may heartbreak a girl. Yeah. She changes her fucking hair color. She thinks she got to go to the gym.
Everything.
Let me tell you something. Girl, that may have been nothing wrong with you. It was the fuck up guy. Because yeah. I was fucked up. I was only trying to get your pussy. So I was conniving you.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so I had to tell the girl, and she was like, if you want to come back in my life, you could.
Because like, now that's even more admirable. You know what I'm saying? Like, you keeping it real with her at that time. But I do feel where you're coming from with that. I think the one thing, though, it's so hard to walk in like that perfect light.
Yeah.
Sure.
You know
sure.
what I'm saying? It's hard to walk in that perfect light.
I don't want to say a crutch, but, you know, there's always something that
there's
we
something.
Have.
Everybody got a vice.
Vice, yeah. There we go.
Everybody has, like, something that they're trying to conquer within themselves.
Yeah.
And until you realize what that thing is that's holding you back, you're going to keep failing. You know what I'm saying? So it's about identifying what that weight is on you. It could be something emotional. It could be financial. Most people think it's financial, and it's not.
Right. Because
then you get the money, and you still got emotional
exactly,
issues.
Exactly, right. Exactly.
Like, you don't even know how to
need a doctor.
You need a doctor. You need somebody to really talk to, like you was talking about, like, the whole therapy thing.
Yep.
And I feel like more people are really messed up in the head within this game.
Mm.
You know what I mean? This game will give you false love.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, everybody talks about Drake. I mean, he's talking about that fake love and all that stuff. He's at the highest level of it, so he's able to see it in a certain way. But everybody goes through that.
Mm.
And until you're able to recognize what it is in you that's holding you back, you're not going to be able to go forward. And when you recognize it, try to treat it and be diligent.
Exactly,
on it.
Exactly.
And that's so hard for people to grasp and hold on to. Because some people want that crutch. That crutch gets you extra help when all the help that you need is within you.
Right.
And it's also pain that people medicate, you know, and you know, what they go through. Because it's
Molly,
like,
Percocet. what Kendrick just said? This my soul speak. That's the meds talking.
Yeah.
He said that on Humble.
Yeah.
That's that line right there. Forget all the stretch mark stuff and all of that. Kendrick said, this is my soul speak.
Mm.
I love that term because I've used it before. And then he said, "That's what you're doing is meds talking. That's medication that you're using to down yourself so you could deal with life.
Right.
Sure.
But my soul is speaking. If you let your soul speak, watch how great you be."
Yeah. You know, and I tell you, like, even when I'm trying to be honest with you personally, I'm just trying to wake up and like the doctor was telling me on last episode, find more reasons to be happy.
Word,
find,
man.
Look at what I'm blessed
man,
about. Like, yo,
listen.
You know what I realized too? You could
find more reason to be happy. I love that.
Yeah, and that's what I'm doing. I'm finding and I'm looking for them. Because when you look for negative shit to happen or you focus on negative, that's all happens. Like,
right.
Yo, sometimes I wake up and I realize, yo, let me tell you something.
Somebody
no matter
didn't
what,
wake up today.
It's the little things in life that matter.
Yo, it's
I'm telling
so
you
little,
right now.
It's so little to the point, like, if I get my favorite bag of potato chips, I'm mad happy. I'm like,
wrap snacks?
What kind of chips is those?
Yo, it's the barbecue Lays. Oh, they got the barbecue Lays. They got the big bag.
Yeah.
I'll be mad happy.
Girl Scout, the Thin Mint cookies in the freezer. That's all I need.
Yo, I like cheese sunflower seeds.
No, my favorite thing in life, though. My favorite thing. You said the what?
Cheese sunflower seeds.
You super hood.
Yeah. Dry mouth.
Yo, that's straight quarter water. That's the only thing that could quench that thirst is quarter water.
I like cheese sunflower seeds.
You like ice blue quarter waters probably, too.
I do like the blue ones. Yeah.
My favorite thing. Favorite. Nestle Crunch, yo. You bring a Nestle Crunch, your story getting up on it.
Remember they had the white chocolate one?
Yeah, but see,
that's white supremacy. Nestle Crunch was
Nestle
made
Crunch.
To be what it is. Stop
if
trying
Nestle
to change
Crunch
that shit.
Wants anybody to, like, sponsor them or be a spokesman, I'm here, B. I'm here.
Yo, you know, as we're talking about just being a nice guy and talking about, you know, just being real, you know, you went to Baruch College.
I went to Baruch College.
But did you work at, like, some type of library where you were helping people read?
I did, man.
Who was these?
I was at New York Public Library. My godmother, Aunt Louise, what up? She got me the job there at Seward Park Library, Lower East Side. I was there for 2 years. I taught illiterate adults how to read, write, and use computers. And they were the biggest inspiration to me to get into the field that I'm in, because I used to buy magazines, mad rap magazines and stuff. I used to bring them. I used to have them reading them and stuff. Like, yo, this is such and such. This is such and such. And I used to have them practice on some of that stuff. And I remember this one gentleman, older head. I hope he's doing well. I wish we stayed in touch. His name is Larry Cook. If anyone knows him, please get him in contact with me. He told me one day, he was like, yo, you always come in here with these magazines and stuff talking about you could write this and all that. If I could do what you do for us, I'd be all over those magazines. I'd be in every last one of them, everywhere. That's what you should be doing. He was like, yo, you did us. You got us right. You should be doing that.
Listen, you're doing some of God's work, though. Yo, you did some of God's work.
I did. And still doing. I hope I'm still doing that. You know, sometimes, you know, I think in everyone's travels in life, I think they're trying to figure out what their, you know, life purpose is and all of that. Some people don't even think that deep. It's like, yo, I'm trying to eat today.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? What's today?
Where's the blunt at?
Where's the blunt? What am I doing? How am I going to be good today? You know what I'm saying? And now I'm at this age where I just want my daughters and my wife and my family to be good. All my friends, people that I inspire, I just want to be able to emit that energy. And it's hard sometimes because nobody's perfect. Yeah. Everybody has those, you know, dark thoughts and all of that stuff. But for the most part, I'm looking to be like that good person that people can come to and I can help.
Yeah,
and hopefully in that I end up helping myself.
Sure, sure. And I think that's what it does. It's therapeutic, and I think that when you wind up doing stuff like that in the interim, you know, it helps you also.
No doubt.
You speak about books and how important they are, and think about you taught people how to read, and then being in publishing for so long. Where do you see? I mean, I know magazines are making some magazines are closing, some magazines
it's
are coming
all
back.
About brands now, man.
Do you still believe magazines could sell?
I do. I think we're magazines, and I say we because I'm such a magazine head. I think what's going to happen is we're probably at maybe its lowest point right now because so many have, you know, shut down and not sell. I think it's going to go the way of vinyl, like how vinyl is coming back now. I think it's going to be specialized magazines that are going to make an impact, and it's going to be something that you want to have, like an annual or, you know, a coffee table type magazine or whatever. And I think those are the things that are going to stand the test of time.
Now that, because Vibe got bought by Hollywood Reporter.
And Billboard. Yep.
And Billboard. Are they trying to whitewash the urban culture? Or are they trying, what are they trying to do?
Not at all. I think what they did was they doubled down and was like, yo, we want to get into urban culture.
Okay.
You know, I think what they wanted to do was gain even more credibility within the space. Billboard, on its own, is just 100 plus years of, you know, just straight stats and data about every genre of music ever. And for them to look at hip hop and say like, all right, we really want to invest in this now by getting Vibe and getting Spin and the other properties, I think that's important for the culture. Hollywood Reporter, on the other hand, I love seeing what they do. They're being nominated for like different awards for their video content. Janice Min just stepped up into like the super echelon of the brand, and now she's looking around and they have like new leadership and all of that stuff. So it's a lot of new things that's going on with the brand. But I'm also learning. I'm like right now in our company, I'm sitting around like all the marketing and sales people, and I'm learning a lot too. Even at this age. So I'm looking at it like, all right, what do I need to know about this new world that we're going into, where the marketing team is always dealing with like digital properties that want to buy and sell and be featured and all that stuff. I want to see what's going next so I could be ahead of the curve.
Always keeping an open mind.
Got to.
You know, you have a Puff story that I heard you say before. Can you tell the Internet's story?
The intern one?
Yeah. Tell the Internet's the intern Puff story.
So basically, before I got to Vibe in 96, my cousin L and I, we were going to a pool party, and we was like, yo, we got to get fresh. So back then, to get fresh, you would go down to the Village, and Russell, ironically enough, he had Fat Farm. He had a Fat Farm store. So I was like, yo, if we get there mad early, we'll get the hot stuff. you know, from Fat Farm. Like, you know, we had a couple of dollars on it. So we got there like at 10 o'clock when they opened up. It was a Saturday morning. We was going to the pool party later. As we're walking up, I see this big body Benz. I'm like, damn, we don't even see no big body Benz, you know, on Prince Street early right. in the morning. But Puff is by himself walking up and down, talking on like he was ahead of his time. He had the little piece to the phone
right.
already, looking like Russell. So I'm like, oh, yo, L, they go Puff. He was like, leave him alone, because he know what I'm thinking. He know how I get down. My cousin know how I get down. So he was like, leave him alone. I was like, yo, I'm going to ask for an internship. I ain't asking for a job, because he going to say no. He was like, he going to say no of an internship, too. So, boom. So Puff crosses the street, and as he crosses the street, I'm like, yo, Puff. And he was like, yo, what up? He had a straw in his mouth, and he's chewing on a straw like bad boy. Yeah.
Like he always does.
Like he always do. He had a hat backwards and everything. And I was like, yo, man, like, my name is Datwon. I'm from Brooklyn. Biggie, baby, all that. Yo, I'll do whatever for bad boy. Run, get coffee, all that.
Cheesecake,
the whole cheesecake wasn't around yet. But if I knew that, I would have said it. And he was like, "Word." I was like, yeah, do you have any intern slots open? And he took the, he took the straw out of his mouth, and a big gob of spit came with the straw. And shit. He was just like, nah. I was like, oh shit. Yo, it was the biggest punch in the face. I was like, all right. See you at the top.
That's
he was
crazy.
Like, he looked and he was like, all right. And then he walked in, and then I was like, we can't go in there now.
did you ever get a chance to tell him that story again?
I never told him, but I think he probably heard it.
He knows.
Yeah.
But I've worked with him so many times. So boom, fast forward 11 years later, in 2006, I'm editor-in-chief of Vibe. Mm-hmm. I mean, of King.
Mm-hmm.
And he had the, what was it? Forever?
King?
Nah, Press Play album.
Mm.
And I made him the guest editor for that whole issue. And now Puff got to listen to me and on the edit stuff, and I'm listening to his suggestions, and we're collaborating on my issue together. And he wrote an editorial, and I wrote an editorial, and I told that story a little bit, and our editorials are side by side.
Yeah.
And in that moment, I was like, yo, I told this dude I was going to see him at the top.
Now it's full circle.
Now we working. That's right. Let's get it.
I would have came in with a straw in my mouth. Nah.
And the gobble spit
let's
hanging.
Let's get it.
And listen, that's classic. It's classic, and it's great to hear. You know what? Let's take a moment and go on to our segment. I don't trust people. Datwon, I don't know if you know about this, but when I was starting the show, I says, you know what? I used to tweet this hashtag called I don't trust people.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, you know what? We're going to make this a segment. And listen, it is the most longest standing segment on the show.
Uh-huh.
Internet, you know how to get involved. Hashtag I don't trust people on Twitter. Let us know who you don't trust, what you don't trust. And as I always say, if it ain't no fuck shit, we'll feature it on a future episode. Who we got submitted this week?
Our first submission comes from the legend Eric. I don't trust people who wash paper plates and cups. Throw them shits out, fam.
And listen, I agree. I mean, you're defeating the purpose. Like, you know what I mean? Like, it's funny because I told my lady this week, like, every time I turn around in my house, there's fucking dishes in the sink.
I think that's, first of all, that's black because my grandmother don't play. Unless it got the spaghetti stain on the styrofoam that ain't coming out, you washing that.
Remember, hold up. I want to make a point that my lady said. My mother-in-law, to be, uses plastic forks. She said, oh, no, I use plastic forks now, but she washes them.
Right.
I said, Ma, why are you doing that?
Yeah.
She says, oh, because I don't want to deal with silverware. But aren't you doing the same thing? You could just be washing your regular fucking thing.
No, it's because when company comes over,
then you
throw
that
shit
out.
Let me tell you something.
You give them the styrofoam and plastic, and you throw it out.
Yeah.
But if it's house, you ain't going to reuse that cup again and again.
No. But the cup, I understand you put your fucking name on it.
Not
you understand
name.
If you have a party. Yeah, you put your name on that joint. Because you ain't coming for all these solos. But if you're doing the whole paper shit, throw that fucking shit the fuck out.
Yo, that's crazy.
Yeah, who we got next?
Our that's next hilarious. One comes from Cap Thoughts. I don't trust people who speak only with their bottom teeth.
I mean, it's
an underbite, right?
I mean, that's a person that seems like a personal problem.
That's like one of the monsters on
Mr. Ed.
No, like one of the Muppets. The red one.
Hey, you know, I'm...
Monster.
I'm not in the
like
mood.
Grady or somebody from San Francisco.
I'm not in the mood to make fun of people like that. That could be a problem.
The next one comes from T Money Sick. I don't trust people who say, swear for God. He doesn't need your cosign. First of all,
swear for God.
Not for God.
For God.
Not for him.
Hey, you know, it could be his cliche.
Don't use the Lord's name in vain. I don't trust you either.
I agree. Only on Sunday.
Only Jesus.
If you're putting an offering in the basket.
You can't be saying for God now. Let's just G-A-W-D.
There we go. Who else we got?
Our next one comes from 1987 EMB. I don't trust people with stickers on their fitteds.
You know,
to my heart right now.
I say that a lot. I say that a lot, but then I realize there's a lot of people I know that still do
that
it.
That still so. Do it, yeah. Yeah.
I don't like it either.
Yo. I let it go.
I hate it. And I especially hate it when I finally get to take it off and it has
the
clean
has a circle.
Rim.
Yeah, because you waited too long.
The dust done got to it.
Yeah, you dusty. Next one comes from our honorary host Fidel Fresco.
Oh, this guy, he always submits.
This is our home skillet. That's why I saved you for last.
Right.
I don't trust people who post pictures of sick family members in the hospital.
You know, I seen that. And actually, I don't fully agree with that. And I'm going to explain to you why. There are people, like, I don't believe, like, here's the thing, right?
Uh-huh.
I'm on social media.
Yeah.
I tweet a lot. You know, I don't Instagram as much, but I do Instagram. But here's the thing, as much as I show, there's a lot I don't show,
right?
You know, I'm somewhat private, you know, because I like my little time to myself.
Okay,
I love social media, but here's the point: some people I've seen it. Like you look at somebody like Pretty Lou,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Social media inspires that guy to fight every day for what his cancer he's battling.
Yep.
It's a great guy.
That's my guy. He hosted my daughter's Sweet 16.
Nice, you know what I mean?
Love him.
But the point I'm trying to make is he. He enjoys that. I'm sure he enjoys the people. So the point I'm making...
Well, he's saying he doesn't trust people who post their family members. So Pretty Lou Cousin
but
can't
here's
be posting
the thing.
Pictures
if
of
If my
Lou.
Grandmother's in the hospital, I may take a picture of her and say, yo, internet, say a prayer for grandma. She ain't
trust
doing
you.
So well.
You don't trust me?
No, because you know how many people are going to put negative energy?
Yeah.
I feel like I'm going with my man Fidel. I believe in what Pretty Lou is doing because it's a bigger picture. It's him posing himself for people that don't know. And, you know, but I feel like it has to be like a level. Like, you can't call your best friend or your cousin or your mom or something. Like, why are you on social? Like, my mother, when she had a heart attack.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody called me and was like, is your mother okay? And I'm like, well, how do you know? And like, she's on Facebook. I cursed her out. I said, you in the hospital?
Well,
you
that's
attention?
The problem. See,
on?
First of all, that's the first.
Your heart hurt or your heart
I don't
hurt.
Trust you. I don't trust you. You know why? You know why I don't trust you? Because you mentioned Facebook. That's the problem. Everybody's complaining on Facebook. People tell you everything on Facebook.
Yeah, that's right.
That's why I stopped using Facebook 5 years ago. I pressed delete. They're like, we'll wait right here. You can come back anytime you want. No, get me the fuck up out of here.
They waiting on you.
Yeah,
man. They know you're coming back.
Anyway, listen, internet, says you have something you don't trust, or you know, it could be like something or a person or a place or a thing.
Damn, man, that's crazy.
I don't trust people that say ah. Or then when they be like long story short, or this, that, and the third, don't trust you.
Well, I'll tell you, get what do you got?
Well, you said this, that, and the third.
This, that, and the third. I hate that. It's
Damn,
never,
it's
never
one of those I use. I think. Yeah. I think like, yo, da 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 da. Or some people be like, la di da di da. Or what's the one everybody use? It's something like that.
It's not That's a new shit.
It could be, to be honest with you, sometimes this.
Oh, some people be like, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Or whatever. Nah, that other one, though.
This, that, and the third?
I think I do that.
That's how you know you're about to get lied to.
You're about to get lied to. You're about to get finessed all day.
Yeah. He don't want to tell you the real shit. And
the
then this,
shit.
That, and the third.
This, that, and the third. Like, what?
What is it? Because Troy asked her that so many times in that Breakfast Club interview.
Oh, yeah, yeah,
I needed
yeah.
to know.
Hey, listen, we neutral in this game. But for the most part, you got to understand, sometimes you don't trust yourself sometimes. There's things I've
a
done.
A lot
that
of
I,
times, B.
There's things I've done. But anyway, listen, internets, you know how to get involved. Hashtag I don't trust PPL on Twitter or Instagram. fill it up. If it's on Twitter, at Premium Pete Show, Miss Lissa knows. Let us know who you don't trust, what you don't trust, and we'll get you on a future episode. Listen, Datwon, man, as we wind down this episode, and I'll tell you one thing.
Yeah.
There's never enough time to somebody like amazing, you because there's so much shit.
I appreciate that, bro.
You come back to the live show, maybe? Show us some love.
I'll come through.
Listen, we're going to let you know all about that. We're going to let you know all about that. But I will say this. You know, there's a lot of inspiration that people could give off. And I think that, you know, it really helps other people. And it's good that, like, you care. A lot of people only care about themselves.
Yo, people do not care a lot of times.
Think about that shit. Yo, what was your relationship like with Big L?
Oh, man. Me and Big L? Oh, man, dog. Crazy situation. My cousin L, his mom's lived on 140th and Lenox. So we would troop from Brooklyn all the way to Harlem to go see her on different weekends. And every time we went up there, it was this group of dudes that was always out there. And this is before, like, L got to be known as L. He would always be out there. And if you walking up the block and you got some love, you're like, yo, what up, what up? And over time, we just started saying what up, giving him a pound.
Was he still flamboyant?
He was definitely flamboyant, but he was, like, mega down to earth. Always on the block, though. It didn't matter what time of day we was over there. And one day, I remember hearing him on, like, Stretching by Beto or whatever, and I went up there with L, my cousin L.
Right.
And he was out there. I was like, yo, I heard you on the show. He was like, word, you heard? Like, yo, what you think? I was like, yo, you killed it. This is crazy. And he was like, yo, we exchanged numbers, and we always stayed in touch. This is before I got into the industry. This is way before I got into the industry. And then when I got in, I always said, like, yo, I'm going to look out for L, make sure that he get his proper looks and
that's
all
so
that.
Dope.
And I was at XXL, and he was just starting to get everything going. When we did the Great Day in Harlem shoot, and we had over 270-something rappers, I remember standing there on 126th Street, and I'm like, where Big L at? Harlem is not even here.
Right.
So I called him, and he was like, what? Man, rappers are around. What? He's like, I'm on my way. He was there like 5 minutes. He took a cab from 140th to 126th. And when he walked on that block and all those great MCs from Scarface to Fat Joe to Mac 10 to every rapper you could think of, they started showing him love. He grabbed me up and was like, thank you. That's what he said to me that day. I'll never forget it. Right when he did that, we took a picture that everybody sees now. That's on my gram, it's in the mag and all that. When I tell you he was the most genuine dude, like super cool, everything he had planned out, like
it's
all
so
the artists
lyrical.
And stuff, Jay and all of them was looking at him.
Like, Jay was scared. I don't care what nobody said. he made Jay switch his whole style up.
Yo, he was gonna go to Rock. He was gonna go to Rock. I believe that. And, you know, God bless him and his family. I went to the funeral with Johnny Nunez. I remember Johnny came and picked me up.
Camera guy.
That's a cool dude, too.
He came and picked me up from XXL that day, and we drove uptown in his car. That's when he wasn't driving Ferraris and stuff.
Living
you
life.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah, he was different then. We went there, and I got to see his brother come in. You know, they had him in shackles and all that. It was like the most heartbreaking situation to see in that way. Mm-hmm. And I just always like shout him out and make sure like around his birthday and in the passing date I give him some love because he was such a good guy to me. You know what I'm saying?
Do you think that rappers should stay out of their hood when they get to a certain level of fame?
Nah, I don't think so. I think you should go back to the hood. I think you should be there and show people that, hey, I'm of here. But at the same time, you got to know when to do that.
Yeah.
You can't be doing it flossing extra. It should be some kind of like charity drive or whatever the case may be. You can't just be there posted.
And bring your new car and leave it on the corner.
You can't be posted, but you definitely should show love from where you from. Because when you think about it, a lot of the alma maters that people go to when they go to college, they go back and give. The streets for a lot of people is their alma mater. Like, you got to go ahead and give back in there.
Yeah.
And it's hard sometimes for certain people to go back when they get money and all that. And I think certain situations keep people from doing more that they want to do.
You see so many, like, scary situations, even now, like, Chinks and, you know, like...
And, you know, Fetty going back to the hood, I guess, like, the whole chain situation. I don't know if that's exactly what it is, but whenever you're around those elements, it makes it hard for them to want to say, like, hey, you know what, I'm going to go help the hood on some cool, without the press stuff.
Right.
Yeah.
That's going
to
be hard.
That's why I respect J. Cole so much, because he did it under the radar.
Yeah.
You know, As we, I say this all the time, as we wind this episode down now, but we end it,
we end it now.
You know, one thing, I appreciate you coming on. Listen, you respect hip hop. You respect the game. And the game has respected you back.
I appreciate that, and
you know, we wish you more life.
Thank you.
You know, I feel like I'm Khaled right now. I seen a video of him talking to his son. You an icon. Yeah. You the biggest baby, you know.
Those gotta affirmations love that. Going out, that baby going to be a boss.
You're not going to tell a shot anything.
Nothing at all.
Word. And that's what you got to do, though.
I had that on with my daughter the other day.
I do that with my daughter.
And she was like, are we in a trance? I was like, kinda.
I do that. I did that last night, actually. Like, she was stressed about her tests and stuff. It's so crazy that we talk about this. She was stressed about her tests and stuff, and I had to give her that battery. You know what I'm saying? Like you great. Right. I after a while, I started thinking I was Khaled. Mm-hmm. I was like, yo, you loyal.
You great.
You smart.
You doing dope things.
You beautiful.
But I was really like, you got to feed them that.
No, what do you
Because they're getting fed so much other stuff. You got to feed them that. And if it's coming from somebody that's a mom, a dad, an uncle, or whatever, it means much more.
Sure.
So my daughter's not going to lack for that if I'm on this earth.
But how do you balance that? You having, especially with King Magazine, just like women are exploited, publicized for sexuality, but you have three daughters. So how do you tread that line?
I respectfully carry yourself with respect. What I do and what I've produced doesn't have anything to do with how you move in this world. You are a queen. You are someone that's respected, and you have to respect yourself in order to get those that type of respect. And that's one of those things that I just instill in my daughters, man. Like, they get to see how I move, too. I've brought them around to, like, certain situations, and they get to see how I'm respected.
Right.
And I'm just hoping that they absorb that. My brothers as well. You know, my sisters as well. And I think, like, by leading by example, I'm not perfect in no way, shape, or form. I want to be better in everything I do, even to myself. Mm. So if I show a little glimpse of that, then maybe they can take it a step further than what I'm doing for me.
Mm. If your daughter wanted to be like a model or like a video vixen, would you
I would tell her the right way to do it.
Right.
Mm. You know what I mean? Because if I don't, then she's going to do it some old messed up way.
Sure.
You know what I'm saying? And when they were really young, they were modeling. Like,
what is the right way now? Because I just feel like
I think the right way is a respectable way. I don't think you need to have it, you know.
So a woman should be covered up to be respected.
Nah, I'm not saying that. You can be sexy. You can have on a bikini. You can do that and still have your self respect. You can. It's just certain ways that it looks,
and the way you move, and the way you move,
and
the way you move.
And that's how. And that's the reason why King was so successful, is because I wasn't trying to exploit women. I was trying to show their beauty. Sexiness,
you were celebrating them.
You know, sensual, intelligent.
I wish you still were doing it.
I know,
yeah,
man.
Bring it back. At least an Instagram.
An Instagram, bro, right?
That shit.
I just Instagram.
Yo, to leave the internets, leave them with the Tyra Banks story. Mm. What did you do to Tyra Banks?
Ow.
Wow. Pause.
No pause needed.
Nah, he got that ring on pause.
Okay, pause. Nah, nothing to Tyra Banks, but. What I did was, the story goes like this. As we were putting King together, the publishers had like the logos made for King. And they used Tyra Banks as a placeholder because we didn't shoot anything yet. So there was like, which logos you like? And I'm looking at like five different logos. And I remember it was on a black leather couch like this. And I was looking at it. I was like, yo, this is the one right here. I like this one right here. It was chunky. It was right. And they were like, all right, cool. I was like, yeah, and, you know, Tyra Banks is going to look good like that. And it was like, because it was a GQ photo.
Oh.
It was a GQ photo of Tyra Banks from her cover, and they just put it in as a placeholder. And when I said that, they started laughing at me. And I hadn't put one issue out. They was like, ha ha, Tyra Banks, that's what you think you're going to get? You're going to get Tyra Banks? Listen, man, we ain't trying to mess with you or anything like that. don't be so ambitious, man. There you go. You ain't going to lose your job. You don't get. It was like that. And I was like, yo, right at that moment, I was like, I'm getting Tyra Banks. I'm getting Tyra Banks. So I started this thing where I would, on her birthday, December 4th, and on Valentine's Day, I would send flowers and candy.
Oh.
So I started doing that. It took 2.5, almost 3 years. I got a response. I didn't know if she was ever getting them. I sent it to her office. I sent it to her management office. I remember having the I guess I started making some leeway because Benny Medina, the great Benny Medina, the manager.
Fresh the Prince. God.
Yeah, he accepted my invitation for a meeting. We had it at Maritime on 17th and what's that, 10th or 9th? And I had an amazing meeting with him, man. He gave me so many gems outside of my request.
Right.
So I appreciate you, Benny. Thank you. And he was like, yo, we're going to make this happen. Yo, when he said that, it was like, you can't be serious right now, man. Tyra came to the shoot. When I tell you, we did 5 looks in 2 hours. And she had lunch.
Profesh.
That's a professional lady right there.
I've never had a shoot go like that. She was walking by getting ready for one of the other looks, and there was a velvet curtain that was there. She took the curtain, and she ain't have no clothes on. She wrapped it around and was like, take this shot. And that's one of the spread shots. She walked by a fucking curtain. Do y'all hear what
I'm
saying?
Visionary.
A velvet curtain and wrapped it around herself.
What is that,
like,
velvet?
What is this, velvet? And did it, and it was hot.
I like, listen.
She was like, that's look number 4. Let's go. I was like, oh, shit. I was bugging. You know what I mean? And by that time, I was well-versed in having photo shoots and all that stuff. But just seeing her work and how she did it, and then the way her and her mom is a photographer, we was going through the photos like a couple of weeks later. They showed me some stuff that I didn't know, and I got some pointers. And I was just like, wow, man, this is amazing. When I did it, I just looked at them, and I laughed. Like, yeah, don't play me.
Another full circle moment.
And then another moment of proving people wrong.
That's right. Man. And
I
do
like
it.
Doing that to people. But my friend told me that's like the wrong state of mind to have.
No,
it's not.
I
thrive. Like when people tell, I'm like a Dragon Ball Z.
Yeah.
Like when people knock me down, like, I get
Super
more
Saiyan.
Strong.
Listen,
and I kill.
Yep. Use inspiration any way you can.
Okay.
That's true.
Where can they find you on the internet? Day Dog, is it?
Day Dog on Twitter, DAYDOG, and at Datwon, DATWON on IG.
Listen, you hate when people call you Datwon?
All the time. They do it.
Hey, it could be a graffiti type thing.
I got some good friends that still call me that. It's crazy. Just call me Day. Be easy.
Listen, internet, fuck with him. Whatever he's doing, it's always official.
Appreciate that. Thank y'all,
y'all. And listen, not
Thank
only did you come
man.
And drop gems, but you really just, you know, I think you really just explained that, like, anyone could really turn their dreams into reality
right.
if they put in work
Yo,
and
that
things
that.
Can happen and people are going to doubt them, but you never let that stop you.
You never let it stop you. Just keep that positive attitude, y'all.
Internet, Datwon Thomas. Peace. See you next episode. Cheer.
Ow.